On behalf of Asocham family, along with my colleague Vipul, Director Western Region, I am Parminderjeet Kaur, Director Asocham East and Northeast. We welcome you to this forum, which is being organized focusing on the tourism sector of India, being supported by Government of Gujarat Tourism Department, NABARD, the Financial Institution of India, and the Ministry of Tourism, Government of India, and we have Yes Bank as our knowledge partner. In this virtually enabled world, it's our attempt today to take inputs of our experts and the great visionary leaders who have joined today to draw upon a strategy for the way forward for this sector. As a spirited nation, India has braved the unprecedented COVID-19 pandemic. While the crisis affected all the major economies, India's resolve to reach an inspirational ambition of US$5 trillion economy remains unshaken under the strong leadership of our Prime Minister. India stands at present at the cusp of interesting times when we have the big opportunity to make India a global hub, which could be achieved with both the industry and the government working together. We had Asocham Foundation Week, where we marked 101 years of our journey and our services to the nation. And we witnessed appreciation by the PM and acknowledged by various ministers to Asocham's contribution in the growth of the industry and the country. And with this, we firmly believe that the next phase of India's growth will require the country to tap into its cultural heritage and leverage various segments which are increasingly gaining global traction. To support culture and promote tourism, as well as the rural tourism, connecting the rural bases with the national and international circuits, the Ministry of Tourism and various state governments have developed various instruments supporting the villages on the basis of their USPs of culture, or whether it's a bamboo craft, ecotourism, spiritual life, mountain heritages, gurukul structure, folk dance, etc., etc. And these are some of the things which we will be discussing when we interact more with NABARD and NMPB and other agencies. We shall also be joined by the senior government officials from Sikkim, NSM, Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra. Over the years and the recent times, especially, we have witnessed that the domestic tourism is now happening in a more organic fashion as an organized vertical and has a lot of potential. And it's a moment of proud for all of us when we hear that we are rated 6th greatest in the world by the World Economic Forum. Post-corona period, India has just proved to be more safer than other places. However, there are challenges. Tourism industry has been cash starved. Though there are opportunities of medical tourism and ecotourism, and people are increasingly showing more interest in going to tigers or bird or such forest projects rather than going to serene places, what is important is that we also look at the tourism sector in a whole, support the challenges and issues which have come up because of COVID, especially with regard to cash and loan restructuring and the other policies to support. And these are some of the agendas which we'll be talking about today. It is important for all of us to work towards making India an Atmanirbhar Bharat, and Asocham is committed to that. We are honored and privileged that our members here and many of our guests here who are from the industry stand with us and have supported us over the years. We look forward to discuss with them how to make the most out of these challenging times, how to talk about fresh fund infusion and the rocky cash flow which are impacting the industry today. We are privileged, we shall be having with us Srimati Aditi Sunil Thakkare, Honorable Minister of State for Tourism. We shall also be joined by Sushri Usha Thakur, Honorable Minister for Tourism, Government of Madhya Pradesh. Both the states have done exemplary work in promoting tourism. And we would also be interacting with some of the leading experts and the known names of this hospitality sector. We are privileged, and I welcome Sri Ratan Keswani, Deputy Managing Director of the Lemon Tree Hotels. I also welcome Sujit Kanoria ji, Managing Director, Srishti Hotels, representing Kanoria Foundation as well. Sorry, I also welcome Sri Nishit Shah, Managing Director, Stick Group, who are into niche tourism, providing charter aircrafts for the needs of the industry. And we have our knowledge partner being represented by Nikhil Sahani, Senior Group President, Government and Multinational Banking, Yes Bank. To begin with this conversation, Mr. Sahani, I would start with you first. You have an experience of more than 20 years in working across the diverse range of portfolios in banking and the corporate strategy. And you have been instrumental in supporting and guiding various policies across the country, interacting with the state governments when they were trying to formulate their tourism policy. You are well versed of this sector. So we would like to hear from you, Mr. Sahani, first, that what we make out of the current situation and how the government and the industry can join hand together to walk this walk extra mile to revive the sector. Over to you, Mr. Sahani.
Thank you, Padmaji. You know, at the outset, obviously, you know, you're waiting for the honorable ministers, but you know, great that they have joined us at this time. Obviously, there's dignitaries, you know, who are there, you know, who are actually doyens of the industry and know much about this industry. Thank you so much for also joining us. Well, of course, you know, I think it's been a topic of discussion that the travel and tourism sector, which was, you know, a contributor of nearly 6.8% to India's GDP in 2019, it was actually doing about 10.3% of the overall GDP of the world. And of course, the sector employs a very, very significant portion of the global workforce as well as workforce in India. The pandemic, of course, has unfortunately halted the growth curve. You know, overall international decline in tourism is currently estimated at about 70%. The sector is back to mostly 1990 odd levels. In Asian markets, this is expected to impact and affect over 100 million jobs. The estimated loss is a staggering, you know, $3 trillion US dollars. And of course, a survey conducted by the Union, the UN World Tourism Organization, people perceive, you know, the resumption of travel to pre-COVID levels to happen somewhere around 2023. Of course, as Parminderji also mentioned, India was not immune to this pandemic. The government of India had to, you know, kind of take ahead and do some necessary lockdown measures. Businesses have been impacted. There have been a fair amount of initiatives by the government announced to support industries. As banks, we have, you know, kind of been doing our bit in terms of extending emergency credit lines, as well as in terms of giving whatever kind of support we can to most of our clients in these tough times. From the government side, Atmanirbhar Bharat package was introduced, which was specifically focused on MSMEs, which obviously includes tourism, you know, and there were other initiatives also launched, like the Sathi initiative to assist the hospitality industry to continue to operate safely, a database creation through the Nidhi initiative, the Nidhi scheme, and of course, an employability program also through the Incredible India tourist facilitator certification program. And you know, there's also been this, there've been approximately about 68 webinars which have been organized by the government of India, which are called the Dekho Apna Desh series, which is again focused, as Parminderji was mentioning, on the rural side and on the rich cultural heritage of India. The minister is not there, but Maharashtra and Madhya Pradesh, as Parminderji said, have done some really, really good work. Maharashtra has, you know, kind of gone ahead and approved the ease of doing business norms for the hospitality sector by reduction in licenses, created an agro-tourism policy, which came into effect from September 2020. Madhya Pradesh, of course, again, has also been very innovative. It has launched something called Workation. So, you know, vacation rather. So a vacation is converted into a vacation. And vacation, according to me, is going to be the most significant, kind of result of the pandemic, in my view, because a whole lot of Indian tourists have started to look at this aspect. It might impact one industry severely, which is, you know, if the commercial industry that we used to have, the commercial real estate industry, and you will now kind of start to see a lot of people going through the workation category, and I want to be working, but I do not want to be, at site. I want to be, kind of virtually there. So I think that's going to be a very, very significant thing. The Madhya Pradesh government has called it the Intezar Khatam Hua campaign. And that's something which I at least felt was fairly unique. A lot of people believe that tourism, as I said, the UN predicts 2023 as the year when the revival would take place. My fundamental view is, and I stem this from whatever happened during the larger economic downturn way back in 2008-09, when people expected that there will be time for things to revive. I'm very positive, optimistic. I believe things will start to look up very, very soon with the vaccine being around the corner. I think this will kind of get things back on track fairly faster as far as I'm concerned. Maybe we might have a problem in terms of international tourism taking some more time in terms of getting activated. But doyens of the industry who are on this call know what sort of rush is currently there in some of the mountain states of India, as well as some of the beach states in India. Things are really, really starting to come back to normal very, very early. So as I said, I think strengthening tourism infrastructure and services, given the fact that the contactless and the digital thing has come up, I think will be a very, very significant item. And I'm sure there's a session and a discussion on that. Please also to share that we have partnered with ASSOCHAM for a knowledge report on rethinking tourism. And some of the points that I made on vacation, as well as, tourism infrastructure and services getting strengthened will, kind of revive. And there will be different sectors which will get created out of this in a very, very significant form and format. So with that, again, thank you so much to ASSOCHAM for allowing Yes Bank to partner. And we wish all of you, great discussion throughout the session in course of the day. Thank you, Parmandarji.
Thank you so much, Mr. Sani. You have really set the tone and agenda right for other eminent guests to speak. And yes, the matter which you brought forward, Madhya Pradesh, the work which has been done, we will definitely be talking more to Minister to understand what more Madhya Pradesh is planning going forward, because they have been very, very innovative when it comes to promoting tourism in the state. And as you rightly said, we have a very large discussion panel subsequent to this session, where we will be also launching the ASSOCHAM Yes Bank Knowledge Report, which will the session will, of course, be moderated by Mr. Bhupesh Rathore from Yes Bank. And we will have NABARD, Mr. Prashant Dubey, sharing what NABARD is doing financially, how they are supporting the industry. We will have Mr. Shibhashish Chakravarti, who's representing the Ayurveda component. So Ayurvedic tourism, that's something we'll have as an input. We will have Mr. Ashish Madumdar, who will be talking about the cultivation of the medicinal plant and connecting it with the rural tourism. We will have Mr. Amresh Tiwari, the Vice Chairman of Indian Convention Promotion Bureau, who will talk more about the MICE and the convention. And linking it to the tourism. And of course, from the tour operators' perspective, we will have Captain Swadesh Kumar, President in Adventure Tour Operators Association, will be sharing his thoughts. And we will be with us Ms. Vanita Sharma. She's going to be talking about the luxury tourism, because that was also very, very significant, numbers which we were getting in terms of luxury tourism, people coming from abroad, especially with the international audiences. And we will also have Sriram Patel, who's representing Travel Agents Association, is the honorary national treasurer. He'll be sharing the tour operator's concern. So it's quite a broad spectrum of experts we are fortunate we are having with us, who will be sharing their thoughts, helping us come out with some concrete suggestions to be given to the governments and the state governments, and also build an equity between the industry members to take this challenges and going forward. So to begin the conversation, I will now move forward to Sri Sujit Kanoria. So you don't need introduction. You are a person who have been known to the industry, from infrastructure to hospitality to technology to welfare. The entire group is known for tremendous giving away to the society and to the country. So, sir, from the hospitality perspective, your expertise with Srishti Hotels, going forward, what new or what changes we can see in hotel infrastructure development, or how do you see that hotel infrastructure development will happen going forward post-COVID, and what are the challenges which the COVID has brought in?
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, please.
You know, COVID-19 has been the biggest challenge that the global tourism sector has faced till date. Okay, so with work from home culture replacing normal office schedules, virtual meetings replacing physical meetings, conferences, vacations becoming a thing of the past, though it is catching up again. The tourism sector has taken a huge hit because of this particular pandemic. In fact, all the segments of the tourism and hospitality industry have literally come to a standstill due to the pandemic. The United Nations has estimated that there'll be a reduction of close to 58 to 78% in tourist traffic across the world. And you know, it will take time for it to again ramp up. That's what I personally feel. So for the tourism sector in India, I think it is no longer going to be just business in the past way and how we used to do it earlier. And we will need to redefine, refocus, and change the game plan going forward. It is essential to measure the impact of COVID and prepare a cogent strategy involving both the government and the industry stakeholders. And I've classified or categorized it into three phases: the survive short term, revive medium term, and thrive long term. And I think this is a good forum because, you know, with the industry leaders and the government involved, it's a good forum to talk about these three. So in the survive stage, the twin challenges which we have is to save the businesses and save the jobs. The tourism and hospitality industry employs the largest number of people around the world. In India, the industry amounts to almost 10% of the GDP. It is seen as a catalyst for economic development, and that is the magnitude of the industry. The center must provide businesses with institutional access to working capital and enable liquidity through a deferment of loan repayments and extension of licenses. There's a huge amount of issue on also the EPCG license, because, you know, with the pandemic, the entire EPCG, the amount of foreign exchange earning required for that completely goes haywire. So the government needs to actively think about these. The center intends to help small businesses to access working capital, but they should really think about all these licensing issues, the EPCG and the other licensing issues. On the demand side, India has a robust domestic market, which could soften the impact as compared with nations that rely largely on international markets. India receives close to 11 million foreign tourists, which is very small compared to its size and relative potential. At least 24 million Indian tourists travel abroad each year and spend an estimated 25 billion. We must incentivize domestic travel to retain these high spending tourists, which should not be difficult given the international travel restrictions. And we are seeing that catch up at the moment, but we should create a cogent policy for a long term for this as well. Critical to the success of this would be to allay the anxieties of tourists by ensuring that robust protocols for safety, hygiene are in place, which all the hotel chains are doing. While the ray of hope is that vaccines are nearing completion, however, it will take almost, I think, 21 for the world population to substantially be vaccinated, for the mood to start turning different. Especially for long haul travel and more of travel, you know, it will take a bit of time for that to happen again. India is a very diverse country, and you know, we have a lot of story in its villages. So, you know, we can promote, like with Ayurveda, as you said, and we can promote agricultural, rural tourism, because you know, there's so much of different food, language, behavior, lifestyle, culture, customs, and it can be a very, very invigorating experience for everyone. You know, even the domestic, for example, you know, people living in North India, they may not have gone to a village in South India per se and lived there for 2 days or 3 days. So that entire experience can be a huge, huge benefit, both for learnings and both for an experience. Tourism almost never got to see, I believe, the real side of India. Okay, so we have not really seen. So I think this is an opportunity to see it and see the rich heritage of India through the villages. Anyway, it's not a new concept at all. Rural tourism, as you know, in other places also in the world, it's catching up, and it will really catch up, I feel, completely. So I think in the survive stage, we need to think about how to survive by doing things differently. Then in the revive stage, I think the slow easing of international travel restrictions will result in intense competition, as all countries will target same markets. This calls for a nimble and aggressive policy strategy for specific micro markets focused on the intense localized communication through social media, through different marketing channels. We need to prioritize the products, the destinations that would be of interest in the target markets. You know, I was just recently before the lockdown in February, I was in Stockholm, and I was staying at a friend's hotel at the Radisson, and he has converted the entire hotel into a vegan hotel. It's a 300 room hotel, the entire hotel. So I asked him, why have we converted into vegan? So he said, because we believe in sustainability. And that is what I believe, that India traditionally, and we have that in our culture and our ethos for sustainability. So we should promote that. And how we can promote it combined with ecotourism, village tourism, etc., could help us create a differentiation product. Then in the thrive stage, the last stage, I won't take too much time, but in the thrive stage, what I feel is it calls for an adaptation to a fundamentally changed tourism post-COVID. Consumer preferences, tourism policies, the world over are expected to evolve towards achieving greater sustainability, common orientations. And as I said, the sustainability issue will come in worldwide, not only just in India. So we need to take or see this trend and move towards this particular trend, taking cognizance of the environmental costs beyond economic costs. Destination that will move towards a zero carbon footprint along with higher levels of hygiene. Tour operators and hoteliers gravitating towards more responsible and meaningful experiences through minimizing such food miles. And you know, with technology coming in, and we're all talking, hearing about unicorns getting created in the tech sector, okay, because they have been able to perform or do a task more efficiently through technology and reduce inefficiencies and wastage. So, you know, how we adopt that, and the hotel sector is, of course, adopting to some extent, but we need to fast track it and adopt it more and more. So I think overall, this pandemic gives us a great opportunity to press the reset button, you know, and rewire, reset everything in our mind and in the concept of creating the infrastructure for tourism in India. So with this, I'll end my thoughts. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. I would request you to stay connected, as we once we interact with honorable ministers, we will be coming back to you, taking some more inputs from you. And it's really nicely put in by you, survival, revival, and then we talk of thriving. So that's really a good way of setting up the things. I will, in the same context, request Sri Nisha Chaji. Nisha Ji, the whole purpose of my shifting between English and Hindi is liye hai kyunki hamare saath bahut sare aise members join hue hain jo Hindi mein bhi baat karna chahenge aur mantri jab aayengi tab bhi hum Hindi mein baat karenge. To aapka sir business ek aisa hai jahan pe aapne ek niche tourism ko promote kiya hai. चार्टर्ड एयरक्राफ्ट आपके हैं, सर्विस अपार्टमेंट्स आपके हैं, तो उस चीज पर कोविड को लेकर अभी क्या इम्पैक्ट हुआ है और क्या पॉलिसी इंटरवेंशन चाहिए ताकि एविएशन सेक्टर, बिकॉज टूरिज्म की जब हम बात करते हैं तो एविएशन सेक्टर बहुत मायने रखता है, तो एविएशन जो इम्पैक्ट हुआ है उस चीज को हम कैसे आगे बढ़ा सकते हैं, उसके ऊपर हम आपसे राय लेना चाहेंगे.
देखिए, टूरिज्म की जब हम बात करते हैं तब टूरिज्म में ऐसे लार्ज लार्ज कंपोनेंट आप देखें तो उसमें एविएशन पॉलिसीज है, टैक्सेशन पॉलिसीज है, वैक्सीन पॉलिसीज है, और उसका बिजनेस टूरिज्म है, रूरल टूरिज्म है, वो सब में एविएशन का इम्पोर्टेंस है. एनआरआईज जो यहाँ आते हैं उसमें भी एविएशन का इम्पोर्टेंस है, जैसे कि ओपन स्काईज पॉलिसी जो पहले थी और अभी कोविड की वजह से हम नहीं कर पा रहे हैं. तो ऑफकोर्स इंडिया का जो मार्केट है, डोमेस्टिक मार्केट, अपना बिलियन पॉपुलेशन जो है वो बैक करता है टूरिज्म को, लेकिन एनआरआई जो स्पैन करता है उसके साथ में उनका टूरिज्म भी हमें ध्यान में रखना चाहिए. एज यू नो, जैसे देश सब ओपन होंगे टूरिज्म के लिए तो इंडिया को भी ओपन होना पड़ेगा. ओपन स्काई पॉलिसी एज फास्ट एज पॉसिबल उनको लाना चाहिए, वैक्सीन एज फास्ट एज पॉसिबल सबको मिले, चॉइसिस ऑफ वैक्सीन मिले, वो उनको ध्यान में रखना चाहिए ताकि लोग घर से बाहर निकले. आज सपोज मैं घर से बाहर निकलता हूँ तो मैं जू में भी जाता हूँ तो भी एक टूरिज्म है, मैं रेस्टोरेंट में जाता हूँ तो भी टूरिज्म है, मैं होटल में जाता हूँ टूरिज्म है, मैं बिजनेस यू नो कहीं ट्रैवल करता हूँ टूरिज्म है, इरिस्पेक्टिव ऑफ नॉर्मल फ्लाइट और चार्टर फ्लाइट. ठीक है, और उस वो हिसाब से. अच्छा, दूसरा एविएशन में 18% जीएसटी रखा है तो टूरिज्म को लग्जरी जो सरकार देख रही है कि लग्जरी देखे तो लग्जरी की जगह वो उनको देखे कि टूरिज्म इज पार्ट ऑफ लाइफ नाउ, कि एक महीने से ज्यादा कोई घर में रहता नहीं है, मैक्सिमम कोई कहीं ना कहीं बाहर जाने का सोचते हैं, इट्स अ लाइफ स्टाइल. तो वो हिसाब से उनको टैक्सेशन पॉलिसी में भी रिस्ट्रक्चरिंग करना चाहिए. एविएशन का टैक्सेशन हाइएस्ट 18% उन्होंने रखा है तो उनका टैक्सेशन भी उनको कम करना चाहिए. बाकी एक्सेस ऑफ एयर स्ट्रिप, एक्सेस ऑफ इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर जो है वो एक मायने रखता है. छोटी सी छोटी चीज पे प्रदेश में भी एक छोटे छोटी एयर स्ट्रिप हो तो छोटे एयरक्राफ्ट वहां उतर सकते हैं. दूसरा, फॉर एग्जांपल, आई डोंट नो अबाउट द फिजिबिलिटी बट सपोज मनाली का आप एयर स्ट्रिप देख लीजिए तो वहाँ छोटे एयरक्राफ्ट तो जाते हैं, लेकिन अगर उसको लेंथ रनवे की लेंथ बढ़ा दे या ऐसा कुछ ऑप्शन कर दे तो बोइंग 737 320 तक, एयरबस 320 तक वहां अगर उतर सके तो टूरिज्म का फ्लो वहां बढ़ सकेगा. वो सरकार को एक बार सोचना चाहिए कि कितना प्राइवेट एयर स्ट्रिप वो कर सकते हैं. एक मैंने सुना है नए स्पॉट्स भी उनको आइडेंटिफाई करके रखने चाहिए. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, मैंने अभी अभी सुना है हिमालय में एक रिसोर्ट बन रहा है, आई डोंट नो गडकरी साहब जी ने बोला था. तो ऐसे ऐसे टूरिज्म सेक्टर्स में नए नए प्रमोशन करने चाहिए. दुबई जैसे करता है कि हर हर बार हर 3 साल कोई नई चीज हो जाती है वहां पे और लोग वापिस जाते हैं तो रिटर्न टू टूरिज्म भी होता है. सी, कोविड हो चुका है, ऑलमोस्ट वी आर ऑन एंड ऑफ इट, हम अभी आ चुके हैं एंड पे और वैक्सीन भी आ रही है और विद इन ऑफकोर्स 2023 तक हमें वेट करना नहीं है नॉर्मली, और हो सकता है तो 21 एंड तक या हम ये बूस्ट कर पाए जितने से जल्दी हो सकता है तो वो बेहतर है हमारे लिए. दूसरा एक पॉइंट है, सानी साहब ने बोला था ट्रैवल टूरिज्म एंड एविएशन वर्किंग कैपिटल जो रिक्वायरमेंट्स रहती है तो वर्किंग कैपिटल रिक्वायरमेंट्स में मैंने जहां तक यहां पे अनुभव किया है तो ट्रैवल एंड टूरिज्म इंडस्ट्री एंड एविएशन इंडस्ट्री वो नेगेटिव लिस्ट में उन लोग बैंकर्स ने रख दी है. तो वर्किंग कैपिटल ऑलमोस्ट बाकी सब इंडस्ट्री के लिए मिल जाते हैं, लेकिन ट्रैवल एंड टूरिज्म एंड हॉस्पिटल हॉस्पिटैलिटी के लिए शायद बहुत बहुत दिक्कत होती है उसके लिए। तो उनको भी एक बार रिस्ट्रक्चरिंग के लिए ध्यान रखना चाहिए। रिस्ट्रक्चरिंग एक टैबू हो गया है, फाइनेंशियल टैबू हो चुका है कि भाई रिस्ट्रक्चरिंग कोई भी कस्टमर को क्यों चाहिए, कोई कंज्यूमर रिस्ट्रक्चरिंग क्यों मांग रहा है। बट आई थिंक रिस्ट्रक्चरिंग इज वेरी एन नंबर ऑफ टाइम्स शुड बी देयर, बिकॉज कभी कभी कोई बैंक्स के ऐसे रूल्स रेगुलेशन होते हैं कि हम दो बार रिस्ट्रक्चर करते हैं, तीन बार रिस्ट्रक्चर, बट इट इज सपोज टू बी एन नंबर ऑफ टाइम्स, क्योंकि उससे कैश फ्लो बढ़ता है और जैसे ही कैश फ्लो बढ़ता है उससे बैंक ही सेव हो जाती है ऑटोमेटिकली, ये मेरा मानना है।
राइट राइट, आई थिंक इस रीस्ट्रक्चरिंग के इशू पे मैं निखिल सानी जी को दोबारा लाना चाहूंगी, बिकॉज मिस्टर सानी यू आर रिप्रेजेंटिंग बैंक, आप बैंक से हैं और आपको बहुत फाइनेंशियल का इसमें नॉलेज भी है। ये जो मुद्दा उठ के आया है रीस्ट्रक्चरिंग का, वी वुड लाइक टू हैव योर इनपुट्स ऑन दिस।
देखिए इसके अंदर व्हाट जो अभी बैंक्स अभी कर रहे हैं, ऑब्वियसली 20% की जो ओवरऑल फैसिलिटीज हैं एज पर जो गाइडेंस है सुप्रीम कोर्ट की और रेगुलेटर की, 20% जो किसी की भी आउटस्टैंडिंग है उसके ऊपर यू नो इमरजेंसी क्रेडिट लाइन एक्सटेंड करी जा रही है कस्टमर्स को। एंड दूसरा जहां तक सवाल है ऑफ दोज कस्टमर्स हु आर गोइंग टू बी फर्स्ट टाइम बोरोअर्स, उनके लिए भी the overall setup is looking at it very very supportively. देखिए हमारे को overall instructions ये हैं at this particular point in time, and मैं overall instructions आपको as a banking sector बोल रहा हूँ कि हमारे को instructions ये दिए गए हैं कि इस point in time पे आपको पूरा पूरा support extend करना है। and I think जो बात बोली जा रही है कि restructuring taboo है, I think frankly speaking आज की date में as the situation has transpired over the last 9 months, I think वो taboo की feeling at least at this point in time mere hisab se negative hai. I don't think iske andar jo taboo bola jata tha ki restructuring hai to takleef wala hisab kitab hai, I don't think that exists at least at this point in time, because everyone has realized ki at this point in time everyone has to come together and try and support. So to that extent mere hisab se bhi restructuring ka taboo ka concept bilkul nahi hai. I can say that very safely for our institution.
आई थिंक आप जब बात कर रहे थे, आई सॉ मिस्टर केसवानी रेजिंग फिंगर, नॉट इन एग्रीमेंट विद यू। सो आई थिंक व्हाट वी विल डू इज, मिस्टर केसवानी, आई वुड लाइक टू हैव योर इनपुट्स, वन टू दिस रीस्ट्रक्चरिंग, टू यू आर अ पर्सन विद 35 इयर्स ऑफ एक्सपीरियंस इन हॉस्पिटैलिटी सेक्टर, एंड इट्स नॉट जस्ट द एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ इंडिया, यू हैव द ग्लोबल एक्सपीरियंस. I would like to have your inputs on the current situation, how we come out, and what should we do going forward.
So I regret I may be a little contrarian to all the speakers before me and maybe after me, and I do apologize if I sound a little strong and contrarian. But just to first address why I was shaking my head and raising my finger, it is completely untrue that the financial institutions and banks are open to extending moratoriums or giving new loans or being flexible to and give hotel projects and hotel owners any kind of extensions, because cash flows are going to be taking a little bit of time. All bankers are making these public statements both to press and in association meets. The reality on the ground, ladies and gentlemen, is it is not happening. I have a hotel to open, a beautiful resort to open in Coorg, as just one example that I can give you. The project was completely funded by the owners. Now, because of the delay, they therefore are reaching out. And every single financial institution has just put them in knots and nothing has come up. So all this that is coming together again and again, I'm sorry to say, is good pronouncements, but you must understand what is happening on the ground, which is completely different from what is being projected and what has been provided by the Kamath Committee as well. Hospitality seems to be just a bad word for financing without realizing the future of it. So that's all I will comment on what was being said. To take all the participants, thank you for inviting me on behalf of Lemon Tree Hotel. So it's the earlier speakers have already said how much the loss of business will be, how long it will take for it to come back to any semblance of pre-COVID. Enough has been said about the contribution and, you know, the employment that the industry gives. So I will first just give everybody the idea of what is our understanding as Lemon Tree and what is happening. We run hotels abroad as well. The same situation that is here in India is the same situation internationally as well. So while we can keep talking about surviving and thriving, right now the industry is in absolute deep trouble. And unless, just like the other international government, something serious is not done in India, what we are very apprehensive of, though that will not affect Lemon Tree Hotels per se, but we are all as an industry partner apprehensive about multiple other owners who are in the business at various tiers. What we are apprehensive about is almost 60% of the standalone supply may disappear. The only supply that might remain will be people who have had no funding needs and they have not taken financing from any bank. Any other owner in our business, whether it is in hotels, travel, or otherwise, without access to genuine capital, that supply is going to drop down. So I would think that the government and the industry needs to look at it very seriously, because it's like a erosion of infrastructure created by wonderful owners in multiple states over the years, and we are only going to let them die. Impact would be very, very large. We were a company that worked very specifically on business models, on relating cost and revenues very carefully. So we were able to, you know, rewind and start to look at different business models whereby whatever revenue was going to come together, we were very, very careful that we should be able to generate cash flow till we come out of it. So that was our survival strategy. And I'm happy to state that in the last 9 months, we've done that well. And at the same time, have continued to open new hotels in a couple of locations. And this growth will continue over the next 3-4 months. We have about 6 openings that are to happen. While the government in multiple states kept changing their rules and regulations, quarantine regulations, all hospitality providers have had to work their brand standards, their SOPs, on their own, really. And I must say, most brands have done this extremely well at a reasonably high cost to the industry and to the hotel and to the P&L. Because we believe that anybody traveling today will not travel for the erstwhile intention that they did. The first part that they will look for is it close by? Is it safe? And am I going to be looked after safely when I arrive at a hotel or take a flight or anything of that kind? Whichever hospitality partner has done that, they are seeing the ambassadorial context of business coming back to them in a larger manner. Having said that, business is not, you know, we are saying the resort locations are doing extremely well. No, they're not doing extremely well. They're only doing well on weekends at rates at 30% lower than what they deserve normally. So a lot of effort has gone into branding within the SOPs around the cleanliness and hygiene themes. And that will have to continue for the next 1-1.5 years till some fear of travel, some fear of exposure starts to fade away. I would also like to urge everybody to, while we are very, very, optimistic about domestic travel versus international travel, I would only say that international travel isn't going to come for the next 2.5 years. Every long haul will take much longer to come back than short haul. So international travel, we keep talking about the 7-8% of international travel that we get. That should not be our priority. Our priority should be to look after the domestic traveler. And if, you know, 17 million people used to travel abroad, then we need to find a way that if they will travel any which way, and they will travel for the experiences that they look for internationally, and that is the customer that we should look for first to market to, so they have a comparable experience with a little bit of customization of what is Indian. That's the first priority. And that's how we will start to, you know, grow from survival to a little bit of revival as we go along, by concentrating our effort on the safety, the hygiene, the environment, the infrastructure that works around the Indian customer, that normally during the course of the year would have gone somewhere abroad. Until the time that the bubbles don't open up and larger number of countries do not open up to Indian travel, I think we've got a great advantage to start to find our roots in that larger travel. And I urge everybody to do that. Coming back to, and you know, lots of things got said by Mr. Kanodia as well as Mr. Sani, so I won't add to that part. My only other part will be, so I've talked about the financing issues, I've talked about, you know, brand standards and around health and hygiene. I think state governments and local governments need to also concentrate on the fact that when they are setting up policies and processes around hygiene and requirements, they must also depict their intensity towards that approach. Because what we see is while there is a little bit of movement happening, the environment around us leads guests to start to misbehave themselves. Because they're generally seeing a loosening of hygiene rules, not much of policing of it. And therefore, they're encouraged to go back to square one as if COVID has gone away and the vaccine has already been put into our arms. And I think government should, you know, take care of that part to say they should not be holding these big rallies and political rallies that just substantiate the part to say, sab kuch theek ho gaya, we are back to square one. If any one of you would travel to a tier two, tier three city and certain areas in Delhi and Gurgaon, you will find that behavior has gone back to normal, as if COVID never existed. If we don't do that as a government and as a policing body, we will not be able to come out of this COVID. The vaccine, as another speaker said, will take about a year to get into people's arms. So we must take these things a little seriously and build the environment around the safety, the infrastructure, the experiences, before we start to go into multiple pieces of announcements around village tourism and cultural tourism and dance tourism. We've done that for many years. This is the time to, you know, step back and say, let's create three thought processes that will help us for the future. Otherwise, every state and every this thing, either for political or sociological reasons, start to string out big announcements around programs, not realizing that at the back end, hospitality and tourism remains a bad word for support or whatever. We also don't seem to realize that, you know, the maximum amount of the right demographic of employment is provided by hospitality. Here at one time, we talk about the demographic dividend of India being, you know, the youngest 22-year-olds up to 35-year-olds. What has the government done to support the unemployment that has just got suddenly created within an educated, good attitude, good personality citizens? We therefore, you know, we should forget the socialism a little bit and start to work segment by segment. You have to support those people too, who are right now either on a, you know, no salary, on a work from home, or they have no employment because they've had to go home because of fears of COVID. So these are the parts that I would urge all associations and government bodies to seek with, rather than broad base our thoughts into multiple themes, which are going to remain themes as all themes remain with the government. So that's all I would urge you to. And I would urge all associations again to reach out to the financial institution and look at the actual reality on the ground. The ground is very different from any announcement that are being made. We've been very lucky because we've been able to get the business back, albeit at lesser rates. We were the first ones to go into quarantine business, which really helped us. Other people were fearful. Our staff was fearful, but they lived up to the culture of the organization and to the as citizens. And subsequently, the little bit of the business that has started to come together by working on our revenue and cost models, we've been able to, you know, at least hold our cash flows alive and don't seem to have a daily worry around it. But if you were to look at any numbers, standalone, singularly owned, or even other chains and airlines, you will realize that the problem is actually very large. And somehow we are seeming to shy away from being candid and direct because it may just sound to be against the pronouncements that we hear in a general marketed manner. I would just urge everybody to bandy together, pick up four segments, work at them, create the infrastructure around them. It's not about creating a village and a dance. You have to have the right experience to reach there too, and then to have the hospitality industry around it. So that's the opening statements that I would make, and you know, I'll await the other speakers to add value to whatever they have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. But I think what you, the points you raised were really, are really important. And I'm sure we will continue having inputs from others and take this discussion further because, as you rightly said, the unemployment has certainly been a big issue. Cash flow has been a big issue. So there's a lot which is happening with the sector, and that's something collectively everyone needs to work together and urge the government to intervene and, you know, suggest and collectively come out with some ways how we can take this forward. So I'll come back to you, sir. We have Mr. Rathore. He's from Yes Bank. Mr. Bhupesh Rathore is Senior President, Head Strategy Government Advisory of Yes Bank. And he has been key in helping us put up this report where a lot of survey and industry input has gone to come out with some thoughts. And I would request Mr. Bhupesh to share some thoughts. And then since we also have Mr. Shivashish Chakravarti, who is the CEO of Indus Valley Ayurvedic Center, will take his input. And then we will come back to we'll come back to Ratan sir, and then try the ministers again who are having some issue with the logins because they are traveling to their constituencies. So I'll go to Bhupesh. Bhupesh, I would like to have some thoughts from you, please.
I need to interrupt. I have told the moderator that I'll be stepping away after my opening remarks.
Okay.
Join in at my session. So any questions that anybody may have, we'll have to wait for when I join in back again. I'll be back for that second session any which way.
Okay, so we are actually sort of overflowing the second session. So you can sir, turn off for a while and then maybe we you know, text you or something and request you to join in again. We can do that.
I mentioned what time I will join in. The second session timing that I will.
Right.
Thank you.
What I recommend, Parminder ji, is since we are running late, so we can skip the part of introduction of the report and that can be done later on.
Yeah, that's what we will do once the ministers are there. We'll do that later. So we carry on with the, having inputs from you and the inputs from other panelists of the session. It's over to you, Mr. Rathore. Bhupesh ji, your mic is turned off. You are on mute. Yes, Bhupesh ji, it's over to you.
You know, before going into the report part, just some of the discussions that have taken place so far. We have covered one of the segments which obviously has been in terms of one of the sub segments of the sector, which is rural tourism, but coming back to some of the points which were raised earlier and which we have tried to address is obviously that while tourism as a sector has been prone to these crises in the past, but nothing like COVID, we don't know when the economies will open up. And in one of the studies which was done by McKinsey, and it kind of highlights the various parts, and it beautifully summarizes, which has also been taken into account in our report. And it says that the crisis will probably, this tourism crisis will pass through four phases, right? So we just can't look at this sector in standalone basis, but it says that the first crisis is obviously point A, which is a crisis period. Second is a pandemic recovery, which is basically the efforts by the government and the various including the citizens as well. The third is which is an economic recovery, which is again where tourism will fall into, and it's more of how the country actually evolves as an economy, and finally a new normal which will bring about certain structural changes in terms of how the business have been happening across various sectors, whether it is the MSME, whether it is the manufacturing, whether it is the service sector, the IT, including tourism, There will be certain structural changes. Some of the segments may come back to the pre-crisis level faster. Some of the segments will see certain structural changes which will kind of define the new normal. Domestic tourism, as has been spoken about, so we've covered this in detail. But one of the points which I wanted to bring forward, which has been covered in the report, is about the creation of tourism infrastructure, right? One part is obviously how you market yourself as a destination. But another part is, which is about, how the tourism infrastructure can be created. Because if you look at the traditional land holdings, which are with the public sector, and the various state government bodies, right? So you have Sachin Pant, who would like to have comment on. And if you see the overall capex, land holds a contribution which is significant in the investment side. So how this particular or a PPP policy can be framed, which can lead to developing not only the quality hotel infrastructure, but also the other experiences, whether it is relating to the island destinations, which has been one of the one of the themes that the government is driving, whether it's the cruise terminals, whether it is the entertainment, the world-class quality entertainment which still lacks in India, right? So these are various themes where we think that once you have a clarity, once you have a clear mapping of the land zones by the state, whether it's done through GIS, you have a clear policy, which is just not an upfront payout in terms of the land, but maybe the payment period is spread out over a period of time, so that the hotel and the other infrastructure providers not only invest but are able to bear the future shocks such as COVID. So these are some of the thoughts that we have tried to cover. And one of the points which we have also covered is since you have veterans from the travel industry, on the segmentation, right? So the monolith versus the micro segment. So monolith obviously would be defined by your traditional luxury, corporate, and other such segments. But obviously now, with customer demanding more micro segments, so I think that is something which was very well articulated by Mr. Keswani in terms of domestic tourism. I mean, obviously, the newer experiences that you create, the newer segments that you identify, which is like a micro segment, is going to be the key. I will discuss all this when I moderate the session. One more point, which is on which was raised by Mr. Keswani on the FI's intent of supporting the the tourism and the hotel industry. The good intent, the way Lemon Tree has done it, the wise capital allocation, the agility of the management to kind of gain whatever was there in the initial lockdown phase, allocating the assets basis that for the COVID, for the quarantine period. I think while one part is where FIs would support, but I think it is also up to the owners. The problem has largely been with these standalone properties, where the investments were largely done more on the ego side, in terms of creating those properties which not properly professionally managed. So these are obviously seeing the brunt of this, and so as an institute, as an FI, we will strive towards working with various owners, the operators, the chains, the institutional structure, and see that how we can support this industry. So that's just a point to Mr. Keswani in terms of our response, and we will cover this in detail when I go back to the moderation. And obviously, hats off to NAVARD. Rural segment has obviously, because the reverse migration has led to a lot of labor going back to their places, and some of the models that they've kind of showcased in terms of supporting the rural ventures. And
okay.
And I'm so, and it is so important to make a mention here, because it is also important that the credit absorption ability is also developed in the rural community, which has been, you know, so hats off to NABARD in playing that particular piece. And we would like to hear from them as we move forward in the session. So that's it from me. You know, so once the report is kind of released, can be read by the audience and obviously the panelists.
Right. I think it's thanks for your initial thoughts. We are awaiting login by NABARD, Mr. Dubey. So Mr. Prashant Dubey, Assistant GM NABARD. So what we will do is the official launch of the knowledge report, which we intend to do, we will just delay it by a few minutes and wait for him to be present in the group when we do it. And I would take this opportunity and request Mr. Rathore to kindly initiate the moderation of the session, the key technical session which we have, where we want to discuss on the strengthening of the tourism infrastructure and the tourism services, where we would also talk about the luxury tourism. We will also talk about Ayurvedic tourism, and we will also have some special comments from NABARD once he joins in. And in between, when we get the opportunity to connect with the ministers, we'll go back to them, connect with them, and have their inputs. We are also have Captain Swadesh Kumar, President, Adventure Tour Operators Association of India. He has joined us. I would pass on the command to Mr. Rathore, requesting him to give a little brief of the session and introduce his panelists and start inviting them for the comment. I may intervene in between if we once we have the Honorable Minister with us. Thank you. Over to you, Mr.
Thank you, Paminder ji. So good afternoon, everyone. Before further delay, I'd like to thank ASSOCHAM for giving us an opportunity to moderate this interesting session. We are indeed privileged to have with us an esteemed panel of speakers to discuss the roadmap post-COVID, which obviously, is like unprecedented. No one actually ever thought that world would, move through this crisis. Actually, for how to strengthen the tourism infrastructure, how do you develop various sub-segments, as I covered initially, and improving tourism services for customer safety and emerging as a safe destination, which is very important for us to, not only deal with, but also market that as well, with various stakeholders, including the government. So let me just take a moment to welcome all the panelists. For the benefit of the panel, I will still read about Mr. Prashant Dubey, who's AGM NABARD, West Bengal region. NABARD has been doing some fantastic work in the rural areas in promoting niche themes such as agritourism and developing credit absorption capacity of the local community. It'll be good to know about some of your interventions in this space when we come. So we'll ask those questions. Mr. Keswani obviously has given his brief, but one thing which I would like to highlight and appreciate that what Lemon Tree has as a group has emerged fairly strong during this pandemic, largely because of many factors, but the two factors which emerge out is obviously the wise capital allocation, the business models that they kept in mind, we were starting this venture. And the third one, which is very important, is the agility of the company to adapt to a new normal. So we'll ask those questions when Mr. Keswani is back. Mr. Amresh Tiwari is the vice chairman of Indian Convention Promotion Bureau and has 30 years of experience in the tourism industry, and specializes in MICE and inbound tours. We'll be keen to know your views on MICE segment with mega investments, being anchored by Government of India and building massive, whether it's about convention facility as a part of DMIC corridor, which gives us an opportunity to promote and host massive scale MICE. However, a lot of it now depends on how world views India as a destination with strict, COVID safety protocols in place. And I believe ICPB has an important role to play in this. So it will be good to know your views on the same, sir. Welcome to the panel. Captain Swadesh Kumar, who is the president of Adventure Tour Operators Association of India, a body of over 500 passionate adventure travel professionals. Captain Kumar has been leading the association's mission to promote adventure tourism in India and create awareness in the overseas market. This segment has a lot of scope, and we would be keen to know from you that how India can become world-class adventure tourism destination with adequate safety norms, availability of skilled manpower and competitive natural assets. Mr. Shibashish Chakravarti is the business advisor and consultant at the Indus Valley Ayurvedic Center. He was previously with the organization as CU and senior vice president. He is engineer, wellness reformer, and management innovator with more than 13 years of experience in wellness and hospitality management. Welcome to the panel, Mr. Chakravarti. Professor Dr. Majumdar, he's the nodal coordinator for regional cum facilitation center, Eastern Region for National Medicinal Plant Board, Ministry of Ayush, which has been the focus of Government of India. So we'll, you know, it'll be good to know more about the role, you know, that has been played by, you know, NMPB in promoting the wellness as a theme so that India creates its niche here. Mr. Sachin Pant is the president of Sre Infra Finance and has 23 years of a long career stint in areas of business planning, private investments, project development, PPP, marketing, partner search, and business development in infrastructure. It's good to have you on the panel, Mr. Pant, and it will be interesting to know various models that are evolving in developing infrastructure in the country. Woman in the hospitality industry. She has joined ITC Hotels as intern in early finding the customers safety, implementing COVID related protocols, and also understanding the gaps where technology could play a leading role. Your sharing of experience will immensely benefit the panel and audience, ma'am. Mr. Shireen Shriram Patel, National Treasurer for Thai, one of the largest travel association with 3,000 members. He's a travel industry veteran and is currently the director of Unicorn Travels. It will be good to know in terms of, you know, how, you know, what is the new normal in terms of, you know, selling India as a destination, the various consumer behavior preferences, you know, making a paradigm shift. So again, welcoming the entire panel, just a couple of points, you know, in terms of which I've already covered. COVID-19 has kind of disrupted the entire tourism industry, mainly, you know, in terms of the investment, obviously the hospitality sector, you know, majorly. And I said, you know, as McKinsey had indicated that this particular, because it's something which no one ever predicted, and, you know, so they have kind of very nicely, you know, divided this into four phases. One is obviously the crisis period. The second is a pandemic recovery, which could be post-vaccination, and then the overall economic recovery, and finally a new normal, which may see certain structural change in way the segments behave in the tourism segment. So with this, you know, the gradual phasing of unlock, the tourism industries have begun to recover. You know, there was a recent article which I read. So obviously not to the optimum. But in November, we read somewhere that the occupancy levels have risen to 35%, but may not be to the you know, to the optimum ARRs or the RevPARs of the hotels. But at least there has been you know, some signs of recovery. You know, spending from domestic tourists, and you know, Goa doing as much as 55% in November. So there are some signs of recovery, obviously not the expectations of the entire industry, but we hope this trend will continue after the vaccinations play their role, you know, in preventing this, you know, pandemic further spreading. Mr. Dubey, if he has joined, then you know, with so I'd again, you know,
I'm there.
Dubey
I'm
has
there.
Been.
Yeah.
Okay. So, Mr. Dubey has been AGM is AGM NABARD West Bengal Regional Office, and he's done some fantastic work in the rural areas in promoting niche themes. So it will be important for us to understand, sir, how are you developing the credit absorption facility, the ability of the rural communities to absorb that credit that you provide. And you know, some of the examples, you know, one such you know, venture that you supported in Karnataka on the agro-tourism and ecotourism theme. So it'll be good to know your thoughts on that, sir. So over to you, Mr. Dubey.
Thank you, Bhupesh.
Over to you, sir.
Mr. Rathore, I'll intervene. I think there's some issue with Prashantji. Yeah, he's back now. Yes. There's some low connectivity, low bandwidth issue with the Prashantji system.
Yeah, there is some issue with the bandwidth. So what I will do, I will switch off my video and then I will talk. Probably that will solve the issue of bandwidth, because we have some issue in our building. Anyways.
Fine with that, sir.
Am I audible, sir? I hope I am audible.
Sir. You're audible, okay. Sir.
Fine. I'll continue. Probably my video will not be visible because we have some issue with the bandwidth. Okay. So thank you, Bhupesh. Let me tell you, first of all, that my posting is in West Bengal Regional Office. So I will talk about NABARD as a whole, but with special reference to West Bengal. So NABARD is doing, as Bhupesh correctly told, that we are the apex bank, of course, in agriculture and rural development. And our role has been not only, providing credit through refinance support and to the state governments, but we also facilitate credit. And facilitation of the credit involves a lot of promotional activities. You correctly told that we have done a lot of promotional activities, like farm sector activities are there, renewable energy is there, different promotional projects like our watershed projects are there, where we take up soil and water conservation activities, crop diversification is there, horticulture, animal husbandry, then of late solar power, then climate resilience, climate change, adaptation, mitigation, all sort of activities. Besides that, we have been promoting, say, self-help groups, off-farm activities are there, rural artisans, those activities also we take up. And it is entire gamut of the rural livelihood, rural development we take. Not only that, with the state governments, we do projects on, say, rural roads, rural bridges, irrigation projects are there. So entire, if you see, we have not left any of the areas of agriculture and rural development and allied activities untouched. So our entire concentration has been not only promotion of the activities, but also how the development can be done through credit. So that has been our focus area. But of late, in our developmental projects, there is a lot of scope for development of the sector we are discussing today, that is tourism. And in few of the projects, like Bhupesh mentioned, one Karnataka project, we have tried to promote rural tourism, or you can say agri-tourism, or you can say eco-tourism, or rather than that, can't we say it as a knowledge tourism? So that word has to be picked up now. Tourism doesn't see, of course, earlier the tourism meant for going for a leisure, going to some historical place. Now, dimension is changing. It may be, a knowledge-based tourism. If you see agriculture, so if you see the new generation, if I see my generation, of course, we have been from that field. I studied agriculture. But if you see the children who are, in the big cities or metro cities, they know slightly less about how agriculture is happening. One day I've shown a sapota fruit to a kid. He said, sir, ye jameen ke niche hota hai kya? Because it looks like potato. I said, no, it grows on a tree. So those things we have to take care of our children, next generation, that they should know what is where, from where the food comes, from where the vegetables come, from where the crop comes. And moreover, the new generation is, a lot of information is available online, a lot of information is available in the digitized form, but still it can't replace the your experience when you go actually to the field. So those things can be in our projects. This tourism industry can think how they can blend this agriculture and rural development aspect, ecotourism aspect, agri-tourism aspect, knowledge tourism aspect in the their programs. Not only that, sir, of late we have been partnering with some of the CSRs. We have partnered with Ambuja Cement, we have partnered with Dalmia Bharat, we have partnered with Tata's, we have been partnering with some agriculture universities also for promoting some of the activities which they have their in their agenda. Like suppose Ambuja Cement, they have in their agenda that they can work in the rural areas, but they were finding it difficult how to push it. So they approached us, and we have been doing it on a 50-50% basis. 50% our funds, 50% that CSR will push it. So what happens, it is a win-win situation for both of us. For them, they are able to utilize their CSR funds. For us, we find it that it is a platform to improve upon our presence in the field, publicize ourselves. People should know. Many times people say what NABARD is doing. Of course, we are not directly connected to people. So that is why rural masses, common people have been knowing very less about our organization. But of late, we also have become, advertisement conscious. We also want to publicize ourselves. So these are the platforms like ASSOCHAM. Of course, directly we are not associated with tourism, but as an industrial body, as a body of the industrial houses, we thought, okay, we'll join them. Not only ASSOCHAM, we are joining with FICCI, we have been partnering with CII, all the big industrial bodies, so that our presence may be felt, not only to the rural masses, but the public as a whole, sir. And you may be, one thing I may like to tell you, that as a part of our development strategy, livelihood is one of the major options, sir. And livelihood, not only we are targeting upon the rural farmers or rural people, they should produce something and sell. The rural tourism can also become a sort of livelihood option for them. If you go to the Northeast, sir, I had been to those areas where you'll find a lot of home stays are coming. And that sector, if tourism industry can target. In West Bengal, sir, I'm in West Bengal, if you go to Kalimpong, Darjeeling, those areas, even in Sikkim, a lot of home stays you'll find. There, you don't only go and stay there and see the natural beauty, but you also learn how they do, what they do, what sort of, if they are artisans, what items they can manufacture, how, and moreover, if it may be possible that somebody may be going as a tourist, but he has something, a business in the back of the mind. So from there, idea may also come to the tourists that someday tourists may become an entrepreneur after going and getting an idea from that place. If you see in some of our, we are working in Bengal, Bakuda and Puglia, that is a dry area, but very good quality rice is produced. We don't know about in cities we eat raw rice, white rice like that. You go there, you'll find brown rice, you'll find golden rice. So those things can be explored, sir. A very exotic varieties. I don't think anyone may be knowing that in our Purulia district, we are producing olive. We have promoted a project where we are producing olives. So those things can be taken up, sir. say the area is very vast. A lot of things can be thought about, sir. I'm stopping here, and in between, if some doubts are there, we may be able to talk about it. Thank you, Bhuvesh. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. You know, you have highlighted, and I think it is important for the banks like NABARD to not only market themselves better, because you're doing a great job in serving the local community. I think kudos to you, sir, especially the way you're supporting the local communities in various aspects by creating the livelihood generation, which is the need of the hour, sir. So thank you so much for that. One of the point which obviously, which NABARD is focusing, and I'm sure when you speak about the homestays and the experiences that are being created, a couple of things, which is one is obviously maybe that the projects that you're supporting should also be kind of, incentivized or to at least get them registered on the state portals in terms of the services, so that they become mainstream and the customer also, are aware in terms of the safety protocols. So that's one part. And obviously there is obviously a need of linkage and GI, since you spoke about Bankura, Purulia, and I guess Bankura is also popular for the metal work. So GI indicators, you have 6 lakh villages. So if you could have maybe a destination, one product or GI, which is only limited to that region, I think that should be the focus, so that it can be marketed, the traceability can be done, and premiums can be earned by the community, sir. So that's with that. Thank you, Mr. Dubey.
Thank you, sir.
And Mr. Keswani, if he's back. Okay, so let me just go back to, since in continuity to Mr. Sachin Pant. Mr. Pant, if India were to build a high quality hotel and tourism infrastructure, largely, when you speak about the island destinations, world-class entertainment zones, even extending the organized or the organized room count or the room inventory, and so there is of private investment that is needed, right? So and land banks, they are actually the most critical resource, because they kind of ramp up the cost or the capex investment. Government, I feel, has a role in this. So what is it, what are the various models that you have been advocating in terms of working with the government and ensure that the concessions have been designed in a manner that the private sector feels completely safe, the contracts have been enforced, and that you have these infrastructure coming up in India which is world class. So over to you, Mr. Pant.
Thank you, Bhupesh. Inviting me in panel discussion. I award appreciation for SOCHAM and Yes Bank both. You have really designed the agenda and the topic for this entire event, connecting tourism, hospitality, and the rural development. I take it more as a regional development and hinterland development, and very nicely designed topic. And there is actually a lot of trickle down effect and impact if you really push sectors like tourism and hospitality. Something which you, in fact, pinpointing your specific question of hotel specific, if you see that hotel as one of the components of the tourism industry, I would extend my thought process much beyond hotel as part of the tourism, which is much beyond hotel infrastructure. It is series of the components which tourism talks about. If you have essentially see tourism, you can broadly see tourism and tourism infrastructure as one category, one more of connecting corridors and communication connections, and within connection it is the corridors, it is the systems and it could be nodes, it could be car parks, bus terminals, railway terminals, airports. Second is stay, which is stay arrangement, which is hotels, various kind of hotels. And third is value-added services. So this is how one has to see tourism in totality. If you see, we in India anyway have a long history of PPP. I am a very strong proponent of PPP projects, and probably country has seen last 3 to 4 decades evolution of many interesting products, many interesting models. We started probably PPP with a BOT kind of terminology, but you have n number of variants and version in this country and being attempted across the sectors. There are many standalone examples if you actually see, but from a tourism infrastructure point of view. And last 1 decade, I have seen, in fact, very interesting projects being privatized on a standalone basis. Just to give you an example, and probably many of my fellow colleagues from the industry would also agree, we have been talking about ropeway privatization, and there are many successful cases of ropeway privatization in the country. In fact, Government of India has also come out with a model document as well. So if you, and ropeway is very much part of tourism infrastructure, and not only tourism infrastructure, ropeway even as part of urban transportation as well. So there are many, and ropeway probably might be a small example. A typical ropeway would probably cost you in the range of 25 to 35. Yeah, they may not be very huge project, but they really give a great impact at the micro level, at a city level, if not at the regional level. Coming again, question of the land being a major constraint. I would just like to point out to something which you had mentioned in your earlier brief. You know, land is surely a constraint in our country for many infrastructure projects and even tourism. And if you talk about hotel and related activities, land could be a major constraint, because that the land is a driver, is a raw material, but it also very costly affairs. But let me link it to the land monetization program of the country, and which is happening at the state government level, the PSU levels, and Government of India level. We have huge public sector undertakings, Rail Land Development Authorities, IRDCs, and many more, MTNLs, BSNLs. They have large, huge tracts of idle land parcels, which have no use. They were taken in 30 years, 40 years, 50 years back for a specific purpose. They have lost that purposes. So probably, though, in bits and pieces, land monetization is happening. And if you actually see the overall objective of land monetization from product point of view, are still seeing land monetization as a real estate foray, or a real estate diversification, or creating a real estate project. I would say we will have to come to this reality that tourism is not real estate, and tourism is also not a pure infrastructure project. But typically, a pure infrastructure projects will have more definitiveness and certainty on the revenue stream. So models are different. A pure real estate project are uncertain and speculative from a revenue point of view. Typically, tourism and tourism infrastructure projects are midway. So we'll have to devise models which are hybrid models, not pure infrastructure oriented models or pure real estate oriented. We have to devise models, and even within the land monetization program of various public sector undertakings, whether it's the state government level or the Government of India level, we'll have to see that tourism is also one of the major themes to and then, though end objective is surely getting the monetary value against the land, or the value capture of the land, but promoting tourism-based kind of projects has to be one of the focus areas as well, which is, and if you see IRSDC model, railway station development, surely it is promoting tourism, because you are developing a node, you are modernizing a node, you are redeveloping a node, but we don't really put much of emphasis from a tourism point of view. So land monetization is probably one of the areas where the major constraints of high cost of lands could be addressed, where many of the tourism projects, specifically the stay arrangement, hotel arrangement, the related infrastructure, could be part of land monetization program. You could have few pilot projects being attempted by Rail Land Development Authority, or LICs, or BSNLs, or MTNLs of the country. So that's my viewpoint. And there is one thing which professionally I have seen as part of a long PPP journey, and since I have been quite extensively involved on the project development side, somehow we have been lacking, and there are a lot of gaps when we conceive project and when we run through the project development stage of the project. That is something very critical, and we need to spend time. And there are critical issues like defining the projects, land availabilities, and finally evolving the best win-win model. We should stop our objective. We should extend our objective, in fact, beyond establishing a viability of a project. We have to.
We have lost you.
Sachinji, I think you've muted yourself somehow. You're speaking, we can see you, but we can't hear you. I think there is some issue with his. Sachinji, can you hear us, please? Because you are. Yeah, we can't. Now.
Just to quote an example, I have attempted at a professional individual level, attempted privatization in states like, and specifically Ropeway I'm referring to, Himachal Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Uttarakhand and Uttar Pradesh. And one of the successful examples, and I would give credit to the government, because at the end of the day, when you talk about privatization, there has to be somebody champion. Whether bureaucracy or political level, who has to really back up the project, back up the concept. UP has last five years, in fact, those projects are up on the ground. UP privatized 3 RuPay projects, state government of UP, and it's I would say a setting example for other states to emulate and to follow up. So there is, I would say, a lot of learning within our country. We need to really conceive things better, package things better. And from a marketing point of view, let's not market tourism projects to hoteliers or real estate. It is the whole gamut of people who could be keen to take up tourism and tourism infrastructure projects.
Thank you, Sachinji. Do you also see a need where, government could think of maybe creating a land monetizing authority at the center, which could probably work with or maybe create the land parcels or the entire database or maybe a repository of the land parcels at the center level, while it is easier to do with the public sector, but at the state it may be a little difficult? But do you foresee something like that solving the issues of the land monetization? Because I remember that there was something which was actually government had taken a call to modernize the railway stations. Obviously there was a lot of land which was available with RLDA and the local zones, but it has not led to any development of tourism infrastructure or whatever the projects that were envisaged in terms of creating the world class railway station. But do you see that that you create one authority which is kind of repository of the entire land availability, at least for the entities which are with the center, and then you kind of run this program? Do you think that there is a possibility of projects now then being commissioned far easily?
It's a very handy suggestion. I would slightly would like to tweak this suggestion in this way. Already, you have parliamentarily statutated authorities of railway, let's say RLDA, or there have been some attempt by public sectors like LICs or Air India or BSNL, MTNL towards monetizing their land. What I would say, whenever you talk to these authorities, they're larger, surely their objective is to monetize land, to get the right value of the land, value capture of the land. Surely, that there's no doubt that has to be the prime objective. But when it comes to the concept of the product which they think on these idle land parcel, you only think of either a residential land use development or a mixed land use or a commercial. Nobody thinks of anything which is tourism centric. What I would rather say, and at least it can be at the Government of India level, and possibly then it will be taken up the state government level too. Let's say RLDA. So RLDA has around 43,000 hectares of land at the pan India level. Can Government of India mandatorily say to a tourism centric development, or a 5% of this land? Even a 5%, 10% will be a huge land being available to tourism centric project. So within these authorities or within these programs of many public sectors, can we prescribe some mandatory limits, or let's say 5 to 10% of entire land needs to be focused towards tourism based projects? So probably that will be a quick runner and quick to happen. Surely in long run, one can think of creating institutions like, again, a land development authority at the government development level or state government level, which only talks about land for tourism-based development. It's a long run game. It takes time. In government, these things takes time. And there is already a program which is running on by various public sector undertakings of government or even state government level. Let's land. Let's have this as part of land monetization policy or the program of that specific authority. For example, IRSDC is still more of station specific. RLDA is doing a lot of city side developments. Can we reserve, let's say, 2 to 3% or 5%? And even 1% of 43,000 hectares is a huge land bank availability, because RLDA owns land in literally each and every city of this country. And I would suggest to this platform, and specifically with SOCHAM with us, we should put this suggestion to Government of India of actually reserving part of the land which are for land monetization for tourism-based activities. And for tourism-based activities, it is tourism and tourism infrastructure. It could be hotel, it could be a convention center, it could be a MICE, it could even be, we have been talking about special tourism zone on the lines of SEZs. But where do we get this land from?
Yeah.
And who says a special tourism zone has to be 2,500 acres? You can very well think of 25 to 50 acres of tourism, special tourism zones.
Thank you, Sachin. We have made note of some of the suggestions that you kind of have given, and there'll be submission obviously through SOCHAM. Appropriately in terms of taking it forward with the government. But let me just quickly go on to Mr. Tiwari. I'll just change the course from tourism infrastructure to the associations which are responsible for getting a lot of inbound tourists, showcasing India as a destination for MICE. Mr. Tiwari, as I understand, correct me if I'm wrong, that if the inbound travel which comes to India, almost 35 to 40% is MICE segment, right? And yes. The outbound which actually goes out of India is almost 40% again, which is MICE.
That's right.
And, I read the numbers. So those are staggering numbers, whether they're right or not. But the total MICE, segment is somewhere around $800 billion, right? And in INR terms, if the India share is approximately what, around 36,000 crores, yes. Maybe lesser than 1%, sir. There was some forecast that which ICBB also made, and this is pre-COVID, obviously, that the aim was to attain that 2.5 to 3% in maybe next 4-5 years. And with government's impetus also on creating certain, massive scale facilities such as the DMIC convention, which is huge facility coming out in the DMIC convention center, which on the DMIC corridor. But obviously, it remains seen, how world will come out of it. And, and we believe obviously leisure and business segment will come out first, then later the MICE. So we would request your views on what is the way forward. The impact obviously is known, but maybe that you detail out, and the role that ICPB needs to play along with the government in showcasing India as a safe destination post the vaccination or during the vaccination period as well. so that the recovery happens faster. So over to you, you know, and what are the various initiatives taken by ICPB in promoting India as a destination for MICE along with other regional chapters or the associations worldwide, sir? So over to you, sir.
Thank you, Bipesi. And on behalf of India Convention Promotion Bureau and the entire MICE industry, I welcome you all and, you know, thank you very much for this platform. The concept of MICE is the result of globalization and economic reforms. Convention industry is a major revenue provider to the tourism industry. It is now becoming one of the prime pillars in the tourism industry. The global MICE industry is estimated to be, as you are saying, upward up around $800 billion, and India's share is less than 1%. This sector has a direct correlation to the GDP. Thus, in line with our GDP share of the world, that is 10%, our first goal post-COVID in 5 years would be double our MICE share to 2.5% of the world, and then doubling it over in the medium term. In the Global International Congress Association ranking, our goal will be to take India's rank in the top 10. As of now, it's a 28. We reached to the 26, but as of now, we are in the 21 currently. We will also aim to benchmark our cities to the top global MICE cities. Currently, we have one city in the top 100 rank, that is New Delhi. Our goal will be having 3 Indian cities in the top 100 in past 5 years, post-COVID, and 6 cities in top 100 in the medium to long term. The World Economic Forum sprang a happy surprise with its prediction that the Indian economy will become the third largest, you know, economy in the world by 2030. Although this data is pre-COVID, only behind the US and China. The economic parameters prevailing in the country is helping India to emerge as a big market for MICE industry. And players in MICE industry segments have geared up to realize the potential of this sector. But COVID-19 impact on the tourism industry in general and MICE industry in a very particular way. It's severe because MICE is about the gathering of the people. Our industry got impacted among first, and negative impact will continue as last segment to revive. MICE is business of gathering people and creating an experience for them. Business is lost and industry is having zero billing since March, and survival is at stake, and there is very huge financial crunch. But technology is creating lots of changes in the MICE industry, I must say and admit. As the prediction says that business travel in future will be reduced by 50%, and virtual event will lead the way along with the work from home. Apps like Zoom, Team, WebEx, and all these become an instant hit, and people find it very, very cost effective to organize meetings. Lots of conferences and events are taking shape in virtual avatar, and hybrid version is going to stay for future event. In fact, during this COVID time, ICPB did their first hybrid event, which was first of kind in India, where we will physically live from the Bangalore, Mumbai, Delhi, Noida, in the 4 places, 100 people were sitting based on the government guidelines, and another 1200 people joined globally, and we make the conference where 2 panelists joined physically, one from US, one from Europe, and that gone a very high degree, matlab, and global industry that taken this. So hybrid was interesting in the future as well. MICE industry was quick to adopt the changes, and lots of industry events are taking shape in this manner. In fact, the Ministry of Tourism, Government of India Initiative, and the FAITH Initiative, the ITM, which is I'm co-chairing, going to be on a hybrid model from 18th to 20th February. Collect, you know, that is the target is the international and domestic buyer. Coronavirus stop MICE event in their tracks. It is unprecedented time for the entire MICE industry, but it will recover without any doubt. I'm very strongly convinced that the physical MICE event will be bounced back. Irrespective of the problem coming, but once since COVID is vaccine is coming, I'm very strongly convinced that, you know, we are human and we all need physical interaction and with other human being. Getting back to normal will take some time, but stakeholders are examining the ROI from both work and you know, so everyone is waiting for the physical event to happen, and that's the only surviving mantra. In today's fast-changing scenario, readiness and crisis management should be integral aspect of MICE event planning. As you are rightly saying, the MICE infrastructure is highly capital-intensive, long-gestation business, and thus we look forward to being also declared as infrastructure benefit to have long-term funding access to low interest rate. As you are saying, the ICC, that is in India International Convention Center, which is a 26,000 crore project, where 7,000 crore rupees is pumped by the government of India, which is coming at the Delhi and the Dwarka Convention Center also, people say. This is purely on a PPP module where you have 500 rooms coming. Convention center, I was just talking to the it's ready in the couple of months and work has almost done. Similarly, if you can see the Pragati Maidan complex, another 2,500 crore rupees has been pumped into the redevelop the complex into a world class where G20 summit is going to be happen. And this is Matab initiative of ITPO that is coming at the Ministry of Tourism. The Geo World Center in Mumbai, which is claiming to the world's biggest convention center, is also coming up with a huge convention center. And a smaller pocket as well, if you see, in fact, day after I'm going to the Khajuraho to see site inspection, Khajuraho Convention Center is coming up. So a small village in the Madhya Pradesh in the Khajuraho is a UNESCO World Heritage Site. They are building a convention center up to 1500 people capacity, which is going to be ready by March. And we are planning to do the inauguration. And that is coming to building up. The airport has been already built. And this airport needed a support, you know, to do the economic revive. And convention can play a very critical role in the MICE industry, where matlab lots of regular business can come. So Khajuraho has come up the convention bureau. Similarly, the old Vidhan Sabha that was in Madhya Pradesh in Bhopal, the Minto Hall, which was a historical building. So Minto Hall has been converted to the convention center with the 1500 pax capacity with the various, you know, the sub breakout room and all the things. So that's turned out to the good convention center. So HICC, high techs, you see the Lulu Convention Center in Cochin, Grand Hyatt, Bologati, even in Kolkata, the Vishwa Bangla Convention Center is a fantastic facilities. They have the created a world-class convention center there. So lots of this kind of development is happening in India, keeping in mind this, the Prime Minister's vision of this $5 trillion economy, or what I can see, India at 75, next year we'll celebrate our 75th Independence Day. And that shows how India is maturing in terms of business. And as you rightly says, 40% is coming to the MICE, and which is having a huge impact on the socioeconomic, you know, the threats of the society. So that will definitely add lots of value and lots of air coming into this field. But policymakers, that's the challenge. Policymaker, Ministry of Tourism, Government of India, Ministry of Commerce, and so many nodal agencies, because tourism is a state subject. So lots of hurdles are there. They need to make few concrete steps with the ICPB to make some bold statement and action plan, like champion sector scheme, creation of MICE bidding funds with ICPB, effective MDA scheme, aggressive media campaign, and separate MICE brand. So there is no sub brand. Incredible India brand needs lots of sub brand for the adventure, for the MICE, for the rural tourism. Humans, most of us are sitting ideal at home since March 2020, and now we heard that vaccine is becoming reality very soon. Expecting to have 5-step recovery from the third quarter 2021 onwards, that's what ICPB is predicting for the MICE industry. Our recovery will start somewhere around, you know, the September, October onwards. In the post-COVID era, we also need to incentive Indian corporates to undertake domestic MICE. So all those 18 million, you know, the outbound traveler going abroad, if we can somehow manage to bring them back to the domestic MICE and prevent Indian MICE events from going abroad, for me to offer a 200% weighted income tax expense benefit to Indian companies which are undertaking MICE event in India, and then only they can do this thing. So I'm talking about the expense benefit. We need to enable IGST for our hotels, which will complete the end-to-end GST chain, and company get GST set up for companies undertaking MICE event in states other than own registration states. So as of now, you are not doing this thing. So we cannot get the set off. Also, our GST rates are one of the highest in the world. And to revive, we should move immediately to 12% GST rate from the 18%. And later on, we need to settle down the GST for the 10%. Medium term with full setup. Top meeting and convention destination globally have attractive incentive programs for meeting planners to consider their destination. India too needs meaningful incentive to boost the sector and to meet global competition. ICPB recommended Government of India to create India MICE Fund with initial 500 crore funding. Under this launch, India MICE Advantage Program, MICE Ambassador Program, Subvention Scheme, etc. But as of it's not happening, and we need to have a collective, inclusive mindset. As my previous speaker was very well talking about, like the railway station, how the tourism industry can, you know, the tourism can be benefited. But honestly speaking, first we need to create an experience. When he was talking about railway station lands and all the thing, I was thinking my tourists actually creating experience and tourism experience for the railway station need a parking. When the group reach there, the coaches need a parking, not 1 kilometer walk to the railway station. I need somebody, when person goes, a tourist cart or tour manager to the railway station, he has to leave the group and go to the platform ticket to queue up. And a platform ticket, you can simply issue a pass charge, 2,000, 3,000 rupees for a year and give the pass, but railway is not giving this from the last 5 years. So they are denying those experience. There is no group booking. If you have a 50, 60 people driving, they are scattered in the various department. There is no group booking concept, you know. So if the coach is coming with the group or the foreign tourist is coming, the porters are asking exorbitant pride in the NDLS and all the places. Sometimes it goes 500 to 5,000 rupees if they see the coach. Otherwise, they will not take the baggage. I was also talking about rural tourism. I just want to highlight, because lots of corporate nowadays doing the training, which is go back to the nature. So instead of doing the training, corporate training, team building, instead of doing in the five-star hotel, they wanted to go to the wilderness. But in the wilderness, like the NABARD was talking about, Mr. Dubey was talking about the loan facility finance, but actually in the land lease, where you are building a training center with the farmers, wasteland, which is not useful. If you build some campsite, if you build a training center, nobody will finance that because land does not belong to you, it belongs to a farmer. So the investment is hurdles here because on the land lease, bank does not finance. So we need to have this inclusive mindset, sit together, understand what the tourism dynamics is that. So rather than taking the consulting role from someone who is not part of the tourism industry, if they include the tourism or the field, where you can bring the tourism and grow it forever. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Tiwari. I think you have highlighted 10-15 points. My recommendation to ASSOCHAM is that they make a note of it. But there were some talks about government creating a corpus for promotion of MICE. Is that happening?
Yeah, I initially, when COVID happened, so we had a vision share with the JS and the tourism minister. We had a couple of round meeting, and we created the fund. We asked the fund requirement. So one, they did with the under champion sector service scheme, where they had created a fund of 1,000 crore rupees that is available to the meeting, incentive, conference, exhibition, where if a foreigners are coming to India to participate in the conference, and if they are staying minimum 3 night and they are staying, so part of the CGST for the first 2 night will be refunded back, subject to a capping of 7,000 or 8,000 rupees per room night. So that's a small initiative, but that's, yes, that's happened. But for, they're asking, looking at international bidding fund. Suppose we need to, you know, bid for the international association to bring them back to the country. So we need to have an aggressive bidding fund. The marketing arm, bureau is actually a marketing arm, but we need to act as a DMO. We need to do this bidding thing. Fund has been sanctioned. So fund has been coming up to our way, but official mail has not been received. But unofficially, yes, I got
thank
some
you.
Very
thank you,
high
Mr. Tiwari. So thank you, Mr. Tiwari. I would recommend ASSOCHAM to make a note of some of the brilliant suggestions that you have given in this forum. But I would quickly now move on to Mr. Keswani, who has to, who has some other engagement. I just saw him. Is it there on the panel?
I'm waving my hand if you can see me.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Keswani. You know, sorry to keep you on hold. So while you made your comments in the initial format, this is more about the experience of Lemon Tree Hotels in terms of, one thing I would like to, make a comment is obviously how Lemon Tree has devised various business models and basis the wise capital allocation. And obviously, the agility of the management in terms of adopting to a new normal. While we're not saying that, you have reached the peak, but at least you have taken certain measures which were the need of the hour. So with that, sir, in your experience, how have you handled the initial phase of lockdown? Largely handling the fixed costs. The second question which comes to my mind is actually, which is related to the hotel industry, at large. Are you seeing change in the repurpose of hotel assets, sir, to various other, the brownfield assets to co-living hospitals, senior citizens, et cetera? And the third question, which is, you may want to comment on the ownership change in the standalone businesses or the over-leveraged property. Do you see that happening currently, sir?
Okay, so you've asked me three questions. Let me just go step by step.
Yeah.
Thank you for complementing the business model. But I think we worked hard at it all over again to see where all additional or erstwhile expenses could be further optimized. We were very good on our room to payroll ratio any which ways, but we had to trim it down. And we found that after trimming it down, it is successful without any loss of service levels. So we've decided that that's the reduced value that we will be working with for at least the next 24 to 48 months. What I'd like to step back and say is that all of us run businesses as tightly or otherwise that we run them. A certain amount of waste always creeps in. It becomes habitual. So this event has actually given us an opportunity to look at every single line item and every single piece of our expenditure to say, go back to the drawing board as if you had to start all over again and work out what is necessary, what is over necessary, and what can be eliminated. And amongst the elimination, even look at what can be eliminated, completely in the future as well, which means that cost cannot come back. So that's how we've kept our cash flows alive. As I said in the morning, we were the first ones to go into quarantine with a little bit of difficulty, but that also helped our cash flows in the first 2 or 3 months before the other businesses start to come together. So that's as far as the business modeling goes. In terms of fixed expenses, very difficult to reduce. Largely the fixed expenses are to do with property taxes and license fees, etc. Those regrettably haven't come down. A couple of states have given some kind of rebates, at least for a short term, on excise fees, etc. But nothing has come down. A couple of states did give some kind of moratoriums on the minimum charges on HLP. So, beyond a point, because the minimum charge or the minimum load charge exists, there's not very much you can do to knock it down unless the government changes their policy. And so if in case one wants to talk about the larger cost of finance and interest, which we've spoken about in the morning, the secondary cost is to do with property as well as payroll. Payroll, we've been able to, like I said about, the third largest cost is heat, light, and power, and the license costs. We get some help from the government or the state governments. Really, that's not an answer that hotels. Your second piece was about standalone hotels and owner hotels. There is an opportunity for brands because I think a lot of owner hotels will either look for partnerships or will look for investments because it'll be very difficult for them to survive otherwise. But largely the other problem, and this is really, I'm talking as a hospitality professional, and I'm worried about the industry and partners who are standalone partners or individual owners, that if they've gone beyond a certain amount of leverage, which is very possible in our business, then that supply would actually use. And for all the calculations that we've done and all the consultants and financial institutions that we have met, there is an apprehension that almost 30 to maybe 50% of the standalone supply might just disappear. So if it is an opportunity for the brands, you know, you have lesser of the demand to chase because the demand will still come back to a certain number. So our numbers go up better. But it would be regrettable if the supply that we have, you know, India has taken time to build over, suddenly erodes in terms of the amount. And the entire development has happened over the last 7 to 12 years, and legitimately so in lots of great locations. It would be sad to let it go. But the only way they will survive is if there is some assistance that is given, as long as their financial models have been done ethically and correctly. I think they need help too. You would ask me a third question too to that. You'd ask me a question on my cost, the supply. What are the third question, if you could remember?
So the third question was obviously, you know, are you seeing change in repurpose of hotel assets to various other multiple uses like co-living, hospital?
Yeah. So it's been spoken about even pre-COVID. The same discussions on Meris calls have been spoken about within COVID as well. It is a thought that is being looked at, but I'm not seeing very much of movement. There is enough supply on co-living that was being chased by multiple players. So I think that will continue. I think the type of co-living buildings will probably go through a change, because now I would think that, you know, no longer can you work with buildings that have no, you know, balconies or have no public spaces and therefore were tightly built and well built for the purpose. But, you know, any of these issues could happen to us again, where I think the world has learned to the fact that open spaces need to be there. So I think there's a rejig that's going on. Many, many consultants and many of the real estate companies have spoken about rejigging their commercial asset into senior living asset, or, you know, merging medical and as well as senior living asset. I think it's a, you know, a thought worth considering by the people who have that asset already available. But it will have to be talked about in two forms. As I said, it is to do with both senior living and also having medical facilities, either on base or very close by. I know of one owner that we deal with where he had built a hotel asset, but he now wants to convert that hotel asset into a medical asset. And therefore, he's talking to a few large hospital companies. And because we have a hospitality asset right next to him, it's possible that he may be able to rejig that part, but it needs some investment and therefore it will look at it differently. It is a thought to chase. There are many discussions around it. I haven't heard of anything coming together in a form as a model yet, but I think it's worth considering.
Mr. Kosani, one more question. You know, are you actually seeing, you know, structural change in the demand, which is, you're largely on the corporate side, sir? I think it will be too soon to comment. But what is your, you know, or maybe again too soon to comment in terms of the operating model, you know, in terms of defining the segments, whether it's rejigging packages for, you know, staycations, work from hotel, etc. And obviously the initiatives, including technology innovations, which could provide the highest safety and hygiene protocols. When do you expect the business to return to normal, assuming that, you know, the vaccination trials that have been on and government completes them with complete efficacy in the timelines that we are reading in the newspaper? When do you expect the business to return to normal, sir, like pre-COVID times?
Okay, so I'll take the last question.
So there are a lot of ceteris paribus.
Yeah, so all I'd say is for the last part of your question, I have now resorted to asking astrologers. But I don't think any one of us anywhere in the world in the travel business or the hospitality business really has an answer. One is, you know, we're jumping into the vaccine. It'll take time to be able to, you know, get into everybody's arms all over the world. Also, therefore, to lose the fear psychosis of the natural traveler. There is a fear psychosis that will still remain with or without the vaccine. So it's difficult to say, but I would think to come to anywhere close to pre-COVID levels would take us at least 24 months. That's a bit of a conservative bet that I'm taking. Where it comes to segmentation, I think all this staycation, you know, working from hotel rooms is a short-term segment. It's not a segment that It's a 7-day segment. People are anyway fed up of sitting at home. Imagine then them sitting in a hotel. I mean, what's the difference? So these are good, you know, things to work with, because there is this revenge movement that's happening for the moment. But it's not a sustainable piece. You can't remodel your hotel or your product to only bank upon that piece, because that will come out from your other part of the asset class that comes together. It is a short one. The second piece is that the traveler today is a different segment altogether. I'm not sure if the traveler of today for every company is their traveler of tomorrow. So let me try and explain. Right now, these short-term staycations, because rates have crashed so much and inventories are available so much, there are a lot of people who were using economy hotels or standalone hotels. They are able to find 3- and 4-star hotels at a very affordable price. The people who were erstwhile vacationers and corporate travelers into 3- and 4-star hotels are finding the 5-star and the 5-star deluxe rates extremely affordable. So therefore, everybody jumping in that experience from the affordability that they've got, and they've got a better product to work with. This is not sustainable. This is just a cash flow model for the moment. I don't think the industry can sustain that kind of volume. And the volume will kind of crash out after a certain amount of time. I don't think so much a movement from this kind of path will be there after the next 3 or 4 months. Largely, then we come back to, you know, breaking it up into tier 2, tier 1 cities, and then commercial or leisure travel. As the previous speakers have spoken, I think, you know, in tier 1, tier 2, about 75% to 80% of your travel will depend upon corporates. Corporate travel may not start for the next 7 to 8 months. And even when it does, I think it'll still be at about 30-40% of the previous level. So that's a problem. So that's your largest traveler in any place. However, strangely enough, tier 2 and tier 3 cities from SME and MSME segments are seeing corporate travel. So there's a bit of a confidence from that part of the segment, but not so much for the larger segment. But that is a survival segment for all hospitality companies. So it's going to be very difficult to bring that suction from any other segment, because all other segments were smaller any which ways, at a different rate any which ways. But to expect that suction to be, you know, brought back by travel agencies, staycation, groups aren't traveling, international travel isn't happening. And as the previous speaker said, conferences, conventions, and MICE, while it needs support, again, is long-haul travel. It's going to take a long, long time to come together, which is why I'm building up a 2-year platform. I would think if everybody came back to at least 70-odd percent of pre-COVID travel this coming financial, you would be very lucky. And then to build it up, and there'll still be discounting that will happen, it will be a staging. But that's presuming that the pandemic situation continues to improve, as for what we are seeing in the moment in India over the next 1 year, and people's habits don't start to go back to normal, because that will only compound the issue like it has in the US and Europe. It's very, very uncertain in how we can say. Till the time corporate travel doesn't begin, the higher end rates don't come into play. Those segments don't come into play. In the resort locations or certain cities, weddings and social functions contributed maybe 12 to 18% of the business. Today, you are reduced to only being able to, you know, occupy 30% of your space if you follow rules and regulations. So, you know, it's uncertain, but that's the kind of time frame that I would give it in any of the segments. And I do believe in the next 12 to 18 months, we will be lucky to get to about 70% of pre-COVID. And about 80%, hopefully 80% of the pre-COVID average rates or RevPARs.
We wish this segment a very faster recovery, sir. Any final word on the revival, since you have to leave the panel and you have some other engagements? Any final word in terms of the support that is needed apart from what you've already mentioned?
I think I was very vocal in the morning, and I apologize. I think the government and industry bodies need to look at this segment today as an important segment. Somehow, with governments, hospitality and travel become sin business or luxury business, therefore not normal for human beings to be. It's a full-fledged industry. It is, you know, it provides serious employment, both direct and indirect. It provides the best employment to your youngest, most educated demographic. And it is in dire need of support. And just announcements by various bodies in the government at all levels and associations and, you know, tabling programs in a wide variety of things isn't going to help our industry. And the longer the support takes to come, if you see every other country, they are, you know, this vertical is given maximum support because you realize the value of it. But we are disbursing our attention plus not giving it segment support. In which case the risk is that I would say 50-60% of your supply chain will break and all of us will therefore grow a little bit of business because the supply is broken. So therefore you get better from the leftover demand because the demand is also going to be short-changed. So that's the challenge. And I think the government and state governments and all associations need to take a look at this vertical as being extremely important, not just for employment, infrastructure development, but also important for, you know, just the marketing sense of the country. Otherwise, we keep sitting in the same place of culture and temples and mountains, and we've got so much to offer and let's do dances. It's not going to get us there. At the end of the day, you know, people have to be encouraged to make business happen and make profitable business happen. Somehow profit seems to be a bad word in hospitality. So I think people need to forget that part, that it is productive business. It's a high cost business. It's a high intensity business. It also is a high, you know, employment hour business. So it's not easy business that seems to only reflect from the luxury. It is serious business. So it's best that everybody gets serious about the serious business. Pronouncements, you know, have been made for many years. And let's not look at the international traveler. Just grow the right segments of the domestic traveler who would have gone at a better rate to a different, and therefore create infrastructure around what people chase abroad, rather than trying to create infrastructure that those people don't need for the moment. Yeah. If they wanted to enjoy the rural tourism, they would have done it a long time ago. And spend other, you know, infrastructure investments into creating that as a customized experience, rather than just a generalized socialist experience. That's the only thing I would say.
Thank you, Mr. Keswani. Thank you for being on the panel, sir. And we'll thank take you. Forward some of your suggestions through ASSOCHAM. Now, let me just quickly move on to Mr. Patel. Mr. Patel, you know, largely representing, obviously, you know, the largest body in terms of, you know, the tour operators. There have been various studies which suggest that travel companies should now work towards understanding the customer segment, right, which may be changed from monoliths to micro segments like corporates and leisure, you know, the earlier defining the industry. You know, but break them down to further smaller micro segments, you know, to make that connect and design or widen the offerings for a customized customer experience. So, you know, what has been your experience? You know, obviously, one is the impact, you know, in particular to the tour operators. Second, the support that the government has given and, you know, with travel restrictions and strict protocols, how Thai is winning back customer confidence and thereby improve the travel experience.
Well, thank you, Mr. Bhupesh. I was impatiently waiting for my turn to come. Well, the impact is over 200%. And since new bookings have stopped 100% and all bookings made before 15th March, too, came under cancellation. In any calamity, it is always the tourism that is the first to get impacted and last to get revived. Furthermore, the impact came from airline refunds, cash countries due to global airspace being shut down for over 60 days. Gradually, domestic skies opened and still we are not even close to 25% of the international operations. Only flights and air bubbles are being operated. The challenge is still there with government restriction flights. We are desperate. But being cooperative, as we understand that safety is the utmost priority. It has been clearly seen and been proven that travel agents and members of Thai have guided the passengers during this pandemic. We appealed and ensured that Ministry of Civil Aviation intervened to push the airlines operating from and to India, start refunding the airfares. Other than Indian Global Airlines got reliefs and funding from their respective government, and most of them, being large carriers, are cash rich, full of reserves, which we highlighted to MOCA, and hence the process began. Due to this effort, our members could reassure the customer that it is our members with whom they dealt with trustworthy. We have a personal connect with the customer, and that bond reassures them of our values. Many OTAs and large tour operators who are not our members put up their hands and even refuse to respond to customers. In respect to strict protocols, the shrinkage of group travel, customization and safety became a key importance. Travelers want now travel within their confined and known circle or with friends to maintain precautions and safety. Domestic travel and Dekho Apna Desh is being promoted, which is allowing our citizens to explore our nation first. With the circulation of the money within India, the economy shall be boosted for sure. For now, this is advantage since each traveler gets the customized package and is not part of the fixed product, which is being picked up from the shelf. Thank you.
Mr. Patel, let me just quickly move over to, Swadeshi, who represents the Adventure Tour Operators, Association. And this is one segment, which has been much talked about, and it's very niche in nature. As I understand, the numbers are staggering. Again, approximately the worldwide, revenues or this particular segment is approximately around $750 billion, if I'm right. With India ranking high on natural asset competitive index, what should be our meaningful, achievable share? Let's say, everything stay on course, the vaccination, the trials, and the disease is contained. What is our meaningful share, in next 5 years post normalcy? And what are the various initiatives that your association has been taking, to promote this particular niche segment, sir? Where safety has been a concern in the past, again, the skilled manpower. So these are some of the questions, some of the topics that you may want to cover.
You have to unmute, Mr.
I apologize. Yes, sorry. I was so engaged listening that I forgot to unmute myself. Good afternoon, my friends. It's a tough call. The first question is survival, and rather than revival. I think we need to survive. But let me tell you, let me talk with my own way, because I prepared myself. The question the gentleman has asked just now, I will answer the last. Let me talk about what the situation is today. Very interestingly, the other day I called Joshimath, a place called before you go to Badrinath, a place called Joshimath. And there's a beautiful ski resort called Oli. And there's a very nice trek to Quarry Pass. I called my man, I said, hey, what's happening? He says, we're very lucky. We have never seen the business so much. Every day, 50, 60, 70 people are coming and going to Quarry Pass. And not me, I have put tents everywhere, and the whole area is full of domestic tourists. It was amazing. And I said, what is the age group of the tourists? The age group of tourists is anything from 19 to 21, 23, 24 youngsters. They want to see the snow, and especially from South India. I called another operator in a place called Sankri, Dehradun. From Dehradun, we go to Sankri to a place. Very interestingly, when I talked to him, he says, and I sent my man to go and check the area itself because of the domestic market. And interestingly, they said he has 100, 150 people going every day to see the snow. A place called Kedarkant Trek, and everybody wants to see this. Again, age group is very youngsters, very middle age or a little older age, very few. Many youngsters. That is a segment of business. And did you know, we also try to follow this. I said, okay, let's be copycat and get business. And we follow the same pattern. Amazingly, the booking comes 3 days before, or 4 days before, or 5 days before. It doesn't come month before, 2 months before, 3 months before. This is a new situation in the market of adventure tourism tracking business concern. Okay, this is small. I thought I'd just give the background of what I'm going to talk to you.
And this is what's happening is, you know, and therefore, if the future was to keep this in mind, the world has changed so much, we don't know what to do. We all have suffered, adventure tourism has suffered. I don't want to go into details what happened, COVID and pre-COVID and stuff like this, and how we're surviving. The best part of our business is, let me take the best part, and that is that people are now going to the nature, open areas. Nature tourism is growing manifold now, but only with domestic market. Yesterday, I was in Minister of Tourism, and I told them, sir, when are we going to open visas? And he looked at me. No way. It's the government to decide. We don't know when the visa will be open. And when the visa is open, there is no way business can come. So these are very tough questions. Even though I don't think even people have answered these questions. Therefore, we have to accept one fact, that is uncertain times, because everybody is expecting businesses boom in March, all of us. In UK, situation went bad, Euro went bad, and so again, the business back to normal, back to square. One gentleman said, we have to prepare ourselves for the business. Adventure tourism is, I mentioned to you, nature-based tourism, where there is the definition of adventure is very clear. It has to have a nature, it has to have an activity, it has to have a human touch, and which is a huge area, everywhere is possible. The growth is good. There are more than 15,000 adventure tour operators across the country. But the tragedy is, that most of them are unemployed now. There's no business. There's no support system to any of us. We're trying very hard, but we are not succeeding. There is a lot of people that are just waiting for them. So the good time to come. I would like to say that the few new things that happen, I mentioned to you. One is a homestay. What's happening is people are going to homestays. Homestays become a new concept. It was an old concept, but it's picking up very fast speed. I remember about seven odd years ago, the Uttarakhand Forest Department had initiated a project for homestays, and they used to give 30 to 40,000 rupees to every home to decorate, to make nice beds, bathroom, etc., for each house or one room. And there have been some fairly good homestays, and same as in Kerala, same as other places. New concept going to happen is, the homestay will be a new thing happening. We all have to get used to it. And this will be give a good competition to the smaller hotels in the smaller places, and because that is expeditional travel itself. Another point I would like to mention here is that youth travel is a future. As I mentioned to you today, every young person is traveling today in the age of 19, 21. 22. I think government has to think in terms of promoting youth tourism, youth travel. At present, I remember many years ago, we used to have youth hostels, but everything just, I don't know what happened to them. And there is now, if anybody wants to do business, to grow in the business, he has to touch the segment of youth. There is a huge potential for this. Giving you another point, my association has initiated a project called Safety Guidelines. About 2017, we brought a nice book, Safety Guidelines. I came to the business about 40 years ago. For about 20, 25, 30 years almost, I've been telling the government, and I've been active in this association thing. I've been telling the government, do not put any restriction on us. We'll self-control, self-motivate, and no restriction, nothing. Only give us a recognition with the gift. There is a system. But now we're going to the government and telling them, sir, please put restriction on us, step out of quality of work and things like this, so that we can actually improve and control ourselves. There's so many actions taking place. People who have no knowledge, nothing, they're just entering the business because they just got 2 months or 2 years of training, or 1 year training as an assistant, as escort. Just open the company. And there are many companies who have only in Bangalore-based companies, or they are in Gurgaon-based companies. They're just only doing booking on computers, and they pass on business to people who have whether they are matured or not. So there's a huge problem of safety. our association is putting a lot of pressure on the government, and we hope that the safety guidelines will be adored. But again, this is a state subject, and we in certain states have adopted our safety guidelines as a part of the business. Let me explain to you one more point, that we need to educate the tourist today. Our tourist has no knowledge, and he needs to, I'm sorry, our tourist has behave in a fashion without respecting the nature. So we need to educate the tourist. Some or the other, there is no advertisement campaign to educate the tourists. I think we need to educate the tourists. The new areas we need to be developed, in our opinion, is gone are the days to promote Taj Mahal or Jaisalmer or Bikaner or those places where people know about it. They're nice, but okay, I think time has come for us to move on. And the new area with future business will be in Northeast. All these seven sisters are Northeast, will have a huge future potential. And I think we need to go to that area. But again, it needs a quality, it needs a lot of huge promotion across the world. So please come to Northeast. And that is absolutely worth. And I think with these words, I would only say this, that our association is committed to promote. At present, we are trying to survive, all of us. So increase in the nation, in the world field, of course, everybody has said about it, the chance of improving the business is very small for the next few months and a year. But we all are looking forward to some good times. And I hope that adventure tourism will flourish manifold, because that is the future. Even if you talk about domestic tourism, adventure tourism is the answer. 80% business, not 80 is too much, but 50% of all business is adventure tourism itself. With these words, I must say that, gentlemen, thank you very much for giving a chance to our association. We are committed to bring one more point I would like to, Simon notes, is skill development. At present, the skill development is a huge problem. There are none of the organizations in the country, education institutes, are giving any skill development in adventure tourism in the classes and courses. Even though certain places are there, but they're not talking about adventure tourism, talking cultural tourism, stuff like this. I think we need to create an infrastructure for skill development in the field of adventure tourism. That is the need of the hour. And I think with these words, I must say thank you to all of you for listening. Thank you.
Thank you, Captain Saab, for those words and the suggestion that all the stakeholders in this particular chain work together to ensure that India is marketed well as adventure tourism destination, and you get your fair share. I'm quickly moving on to the next theme, where I'll invite comments from Shibajish ji and Professor Majumdar. First to Professor Majumdar, and the basic context is obviously that wellness is no longer a niche experience, but it has now become mainstream, essential commodity for daily consumption, which promotes the ancient wellness science known for ages. And the government has been very keen to promote this. So, Professor Saab, first to you, thoughts on that? What is the role of NMPP? What's the role that NMPB is playing? How is it supporting the rural communities in developing various themes, particularly marketing India as a wellness destination, which is again a very niche segment, can earn a lot of foreign exchange, and more than that, can bring wellness to the society.
Thank you very much. I was waiting for your call. Let me at the outset express my sincere thanks to the organizer, ASSOCHAM, for this virtual session, and also the Mrs. Parminder Kaur and Mr. Rathore, on behalf of ASSOCHAM, and my previous speakers, Mr. Dash, Mr. Pant, Mr. Tiwari, Mr. Keswani, Mr. Patel, and Captain Shadesh Kumar. So I would like to, may I show some of the slides as I'd like to share it so that I can restrict my deliberations within a very small point of time. Is it possible? Should I share my slide?
Yes, sir. Sir, right now you are the presenter. You can, sir.
Yeah. Is it now visible?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Now, I am Professor Ashish Mojumdar of Jadavpur University. I am also the nodal coordinator of a regional cum facilitation center, Eastern Region of Ministry of AYUSH, basically National Medicinal Plant Board. Let me tell you just 1 or 2 seconds, 2 minutes, you know, just what is our regional cum facilitation center. Basically, our prime objective is to promote, you know, medicinal plant and the government mission, Government of India mission, for the livelihood of the rural people in the field of medicinal plant cultivation. One of the reasons why we prefer so much of cultivation is that, you know, the stress on the forest resources, basically the natural resources, till now they are heavily dependent on the natural resource, so far the industry is concerned. So what is happening is that it is getting, you know, depleted, and ultimately the resource will be a scarce resource. Most of the species will be endemic. So to do that, so that we can go for livelihood generations, not by only, you know, picking up or collecting the natural resource, but cultivating the medicinal plants, which has a demand in the market, which has a demand in our, you know, AYUSH means everything, you know, all, Unani, Ayurveda, Unani, your homeopathy, every sector, so that we can provide that, you know, the raw materials. That is the important for which we want to promote the thing, you know. And we have such regional centers have been established by the present government in the year of 2017-18. It's, you know, in the 7 regional centers, east, west, north. North, there are 2, and south, and also northeast, and center also, central India, central India. So we are more or less 7 regional centers who are now functioning. And out, and our main purpose is that particular the eastern region, we are capturing the state of Bihar, Jharkhand, Sikkim, Orissa, and you know, West Bengal. So these are the states which we are now capturing. And the main important thing is that we are acting as a one-stop center. You know, basically we can say it's a one-stop center where you can get many things about the cultivation of medicinal plants, the support to the, you know, the linkage to the industry, and so many parameters all related to, you know, medicinal plant sector's development. But the most importantly, why today's, you know, topic of the event or topic of the session, what is most important is that how it could be related to, you know, this our or the opportunity to the tourism. And for us, it's obviously not the very big sector, I'm telling you. It's not the corporate sector. It's only the rural sector. And I'm telling you, the urban and peri-urban people, young people, middle income group, you know, the people, they can really have always an, you know, a desire to go have a good weekend. Nowadays, obviously, people prefer which are eco-friendly and important resources or environmental aspects or environmental significance are there. Those spots they like to visit, as already mentioned by Captain Chadesh Kumar, for the adventure tourism. But I am not talking about the adventure tourism only. I am talking about there are so many, you know, possibility. Now that we have a you know, tourism practices already is there. If you go to Kerala, all of us know that there is a panchakarma treatment based on which there are resources there, people used to stay there, as well as they have the natural therapy, and you know, it has really attracted many of the people from all over India to go to Kerala for this sort of, you know, treatment, natural therapy, and stay enjoying the environment and enjoying the therapy. And accordingly, you know, in West Bengal, we have at Amlachoti, there is a medicinal plants garden, which was situated much earlier, more than 20 years back. And it's a is situated distance at a 14 kilometers from Jhargram. You know, there are so many medicinal plants we see. There is a really a knowledge sharing for the people, and there is an opportunity for the students also, scholars also, scientists, for those who are Ayurveda practitioners, that they have an opportunity to have a to go through whatever the, you know, natural resources present there with the help of you know, nursery raising and other things. And there is a concept in our ministry we call Ayush Gram, that is basically a herbal sort of gardens. And there are many schemes, you know, we need to converge. That is the government sector. So what is most important is that we need to converge all the, you know, schemes, whether pertaining to our Ministry of Ayush, pertaining to tourism, pertaining to, you know, the livelihood, that is what we call, you know, panchayat and livelihood departments of different states and the government of India, that needs to converge their activities together through their different schemes, so that we can have a different places, you know, where we can develop certain village. Like you know, the Mauli Long is one of our in Meghalaya. There is one village which is having a, you know, it becomes a United Nations declared, you know, the Asia's most cleanest village. So that is on environmental, only on aspect of environmental cleanliness. But there could be something like, you know, the Ayush village, where it could be projected, you know, as a you know, place where, which is having the people are dependent on the so far their livelihood is concerned, on the medicinal plant cultivations and so many other things. Now in Nadia there is also there is an effort is being taken to develop an Ayush Gram. The basically objective is that having the herbal medicinal herbal garden in every villages of the household of the villages, so that it can be projected as one of such, you know, attractive village, but the people will happy to go there, and there can be some sort of hotel or some sort of, you know, resource can be built up, obviously for ecotourism purpose. And there, you know, there might be connectivity that we have to ensure through the different work, you know, through the different collaboration, so that suppose in for Nadia, you know, we have a Mayapur, which we call Iskan temple is there, so people can go there, have a, you know, enjoy the Iskon also, which have a lot of every time we have seen that there are a lot of travelers are going there, a lot of people visiting those things, so that can be, you know, conglomerated to make one very attractive place.
And thank you, Professor Saab. If I were to summarize, since we are running short on time, and you know, thank you for being a patient panelist.
I would like to give one information which is very important nowadays, is yeah. That one genus, you know, called Panax. Panax is a nothing but, now everybody of you know, that ginseng. Now it is an Indian ginseng only available in our Sikkim. So we can make some medicinal plant, not only conservation area, but some sort of sanctuaries where the people will go, and that become a very attractive thing for the people, you know, and they can have their business there itself. So these are the different opportunities where we need to converge. Thank you very much for giving me the time. I do understand the shortage in the time. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Saab, for giving that wonderful, you know, the wonderful work that your board is doing with the support of the government. But let me just quickly go on to the practitioner, you know, Shibashish. What has been your experience in that you observed in this particular list? Current ongoing crisis. What are the new trends that you see would emerge, you know, in terms of the products or experiences?
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Rajor. Healthy wishes to all of you from Indus Valley Ayurvedic Center, Mysore. Myself, Shibashish. Yes, I would touch upon three areas of this wellness tourism. One would be retrieve. Are we seeing any green signal there? Then I'll talk about the trend, and then what we expect from the government to take the steps on it. So to audible, Trato, Kelly?
Yeah, you just have 2 minutes to make a
sure. So it is very important to know that what was happening before 2019 so that we know we are retrieving or not, fine. In 2019, India got 6.97 lakhs foreigners only for the wellness tourism purpose came into the India, which is almost 7% of our total tourism crowd comes into. Asia in the world actually basically accommodate 40% of the medical tourism, which is very high. And China, India, Sri Lanka, Thailand shares the percentage. India is in the second percent in that way. But important thing to know that the growth of the industry, whether it's a tourism industry or wellness tourism industry, there's a huge difference. Tourism industry before pandemic was growing in 3.5% CAGR, where wellness tourism industry was growing between 6 to 7%. So that is what now we need to refocus, and with the support from the different platforms like this, podium like this, and the government, we need to take it forward that, you know, wellness tourism, if we refocus that, tourism will, you know, have the better impact to the Indian GDP as well. Now, if I give one practical example, Indus Valley Ayurvedic Center Mysore, starting from that 2020 till March 2021, domestically our business is much better than the last year. And this is very surprising for many of you maybe, but this is what the practically almost 10 to 12% we are surpassing the business of the domestic. And that is what tells we are, you know, reviving, or India already in this mode to retrieve the business. And in our center, we have, it's a wellness destination center. We have a residential facility as well, an Ayurvedic concept, Panchakarma, and also we are doing much better than the previous year before the pandemic, fine. But how it is happening or how much better can happen is only by educating our customer. One of our previous speakers has spoken about it. Educating, building trust, how trust by circulating SOPs, circulating a lot of testimonies, which is the ground reality. When it will reach to our end customer, who are our basically our consumers, then the trust will build and people will come out from the home. Let me talk about the trends. If I see, yes, there is a little bit trend of easy products for immunity. That there is a lot of queries, and that's why a lot of big players like product manufacturer Himalaya and all, they have seen a huge surge in the business already during the pandemic also, because people look for short fixing, how to build the immunity. That is not the way. Players like us, we take the responsibility to educate people that a shortcut is not the way to build your immunity or fight the future diseases. You have to spend time, little money, little energy, accept yoga, Ayurveda, which is your own system, and you'll have that within you. We have seen the trend that in every home nowadays know what is kashaya. People have given up the tea a little bit, and the kashaya is replacing all the tables. All of you also know. So that's a beautiful trend had come into India. I see the positive side of the pandemic, that people now are observing their own subject in a different angle in India, let's talk about, and already adopted. Only people don't give up when the new normal comes and everything okay, they still continue that. Last one is people are allocating a little bit of the fund for health. That is, I see from the business point of view, as we see the trend of the inquiries coming even in this bad business time, people are thinking to allocate little money for their health, which was actually not there before the pandemic, especially in this Asian countries, I would say. Europe, America, already they know health is important, spend a lot of money for the health. But in our part of the world was not there, though yoga is from us. Now they are allocating little time, money, energy for it, which is, I think, is a positive trend. In terms of what we expect is not only government, but government and players like us to do together. Definitely one thing should be better to have a common body set up across the country, along with private practitioners, private players like us, and associate the platform like you and the government, so that suggestions, actions, implementation can be done on the same time. Only suggestions will not work. Okay, we are trying from this kind of platforms, but to see the implementation action happens. Special visa category, always I have been shouted about it. See, I have given the number 3.5% tourism wellness tourism was 6 to 7%. So the special visa category is very deserving particular wellness tourism sector. In India, we have 578 NABH certified or accredited hospital, but JCI, which is called Joint Commission International, which is just 34 to 36 hospitals, which is actually international accreditation. So this is where I think government need to work to increase this number so that internationally, only Indian is known, but this goes a little bit higher level.
Any last comment, Sivashish, in terms of the recommendation? Sorry to cut you short in terms of the time.
Yes, sure.
Benitaji, you know, sorry to, you know, you've been panel. At the front of you know, with so many restrictions in social gatherings, strict protocols, people being concerned about safe and hygiene practice, how are particularly in ITC as a group, and especially the hotel that you represent, how are hotels and restaurants is winning back the customer confidence and improve the footfalls in their industry? Any revival strategy, you know, with respect to, at least even in the short term, with respect to rejig of packages, you know, marketing to provide higher safety and communicating that to the customer segment?
Good afternoon. I'm Benita. I'm the area manager North for Luxury Hotels and the general manager ITC Gwalior. It is clearly visible from the impact on our tour operators that the worst affected are the travel agents, hospitality, and the aviation stakeholders. So the pandemic has had a domino effect, both from management levels to even associate partners of the industry. We seem to have had a bit of joy in quarter three of this financial year. Sorry, my phone is just giving me a second. So the third quarter of the financial year has witnessed a marginal recovery. And this is clearly visible, the main driver being the partial recovery of the domestic leisure segment. Anticipate, again, increase in this travel to motorable destinations to show a steady increase going forward. Having said that, we've got to understand that the COVID vaccine is very much in, you know, today's paper said next week Delhi will start its first vaccine, but the recovery will depend purely on the effective management of this vaccine. While we've seen some kind of recovery, I just want to tell you that you will find that all these masks and all the safety protocols that we had started will continue. I don't believe that it will, it's like a switch that you put on and off. No, I believe that it'll take a while for us to recover, and recovery will be there, but and I hopefully, surely. And of course, this will all depend on how the start of the economy takes place, the sustained recovery economy, which would then trigger off corporate business travel, which will aid the average room rate from going up. And as I said, we're seeing this light at the end of this long, dark tunnel. And we have a lots to look forward to, however. While this is happening, our guests will continue drawn even after they are vaccinated, even after if there is a second dose is done, 100% of people are vaccinated. I feel that our guests will continue to be drawn towards hotels that take care of their well-being. So whether it is adventure tourism or it is wellness or it is Ayurveda or it is pathogen control, at the end of the day, people have had such a jolt that they are bound to look for hotels that will guarantee that they are going to be well. We have been fortunate in ITC Hotels to have a head start as the Responsible Luxury Initiative. which was our guiding premise for over a decade. As part of this ethos, we welcomed guests with our WeAssure program. So we also, in addition to our responsible luxury, we added on the WeAssure protocol, which is ITC Hotel's commitment to health, hygiene, and a safe environment. Through this, our guests were reassured by accreditation from NABH. We were also certified by DNB GL Business Assurance, which is a leading certification body for stringent clinical levels of hygiene and safety. While there is a lot to be said on the ground to ensure the safety and hygiene of our guests and our employees, some of the highlights of our WeAssure program included eco bills, QR codes, low-touch elevator bills, promise, a safe car promise, no-touch, low-touch at our restaurants, extensive use of technology, evolving room cleaning standards, safe distancing measures in hotel restaurants. Ratan had touched upon this, saying that 30%, no, the government allows 50% capacity to be utilized, and we utilized it in a very clever manner. We also brought in acrylic separators in each of the restaurants in order to be able to make people feel they are part of a community, yet they are in a separate bubble unto themselves. We also went on to disinfect all our touch points, you know, frequently touched points like knobs, taps, almost to the degree of up to, you know, almost every hour. The focus was not just to be clean, but near to be clinically clean. The latest addition, and I'd be proud to announce this, this has been in effect right from the time COVID-19 was announced, but we've now got it certified, is a pure air program, which we had. We've had now added on to it an advanced airborne and pathogen neutralizing technology to keep our people safe. So as I mentioned, the first step towards driving footfall is assurance on guests' well-being. The response to our safe protocol has been very encouraging. And coupled with the natural pull we have for our signature cuisine, you know, to take leave from Modesty, Bukhara, Dampuk, Ottomore, to mention a few, have had resounding success, starting with takeaway. And once we opened the doors, there was no turning back. Yet, we wanted to keep our guests safe. So we were very clear that we'd like to maintain the government mandate, not take any protocol when it came to social distancing or curbing of restrictions when it came to numbers or volumes. Of course, visual communication coupled with walking the talk is extremely important. In addition to the ever-evolving protocol, what was very important in the absence of the smiles because of the mask being there, guests needed to feel the smile and the namaste as opposed to seeing the smile behind the mask. So focus was on curating, customizing every single experience for a guest to feel special, for a guest to feel different. Yet we made sure we recreated those moments of trust to get what we've got now is repeat usage. I'm proud to announce that I think for most hotels in the hospitality industry, we're up to about 35% of pre-COVID times. And somewhere I believe, this is my belief, the final recovery will probably be in the financial year 22-23. Although the service designs that we've created to keep evolving and addressing the demands of, you know, today it's COVID-19, then it's COVID-19 plus, and I don't know what else will be there, but we will evolve all our service designs to make sure we meet customer expectations, to address the demands, whether it's staycations, workcations, wellness, virtual banquets, virtual wedding feasts, you know, the feast, virtual wedding will happen, the feast will be ours, low touch service to keep the guest and even our customer very safe. Thank you.
Thank you, Vanita ji, for creating those movement of trust and marketing India as a safe destination and the role that ITC is playing. So congratulations once again, and my sincere apologies and also thank you for being the most patient panelist. So I hand it over now to Parminder, but Sachin wanted to make a point. So Sachin, just last quick point, and then over to Parminder for taking the proceedings forward.
Thanks, Bhupesh. In fact, just wanted to add up, in since you had emphasized on the what kind of models would be more have handy for the not be very great times for very great. They are muted times, but when we talk about PPP and privatization, there is very much a good possibility of attempting few management contract models which are less capital intensive. For existing assets, brownfield assets, assets requires redevelopments, or as opposed to greenfield. So the way bodies like NHAI's or Ministry of Road Transport are monetizing their existing assets, it's a very good opportunity to even attempt pure management contract models for the tourism based projects.
Thank you, Sachin, for this. Yeah, so thank you, Sachin, for this. And let's take it offline in terms of how we can suggest this to various bodies, and entities, and see that some kind of new models evolve in this pandemic era. Over to you, Parminder ji, and I would especially like to thank the industry stalwarts, talking about the emerging trends in hospitality, who have been largely on the ground facing basically the brunt of this COVID. So my special thanks to all the panelists for taking the time out and coming for this panel discussion. Thank you so much. Over to you, Parminder ji.
Thank you. Thank you, Bhupesh ji, for leading the wonderful panel discussion. And before I go for the last bit of it, we have prepared an industry report which has been with our partner Yes Bank, and supported by NABARD. Since we have Shri Dubey ji, Prashant Dubey ji here with us, we would like to take this opportunity and unveil this knowledge report, which has been prepared in partnership with our knowledge partner Yes Bank. The report is basically a focus on the revival agenda, and there are certain key messages which we will be communicating to all through this. And for this report, we really want to thank NABARD for coming forward and supporting. We sincerely acknowledge the financial assistance which we have received from them towards printing of the proceeding. We will be sharing the copies of the same with the stakeholders, with the industry partners and the government officials. Mr. Dubey has anyway in detail shared with you that NABARD, which is the financial bank of India for supporting the agriculture and rural development, who do not come in forefront directly, but then they in turn supports institutions and NGOs who take forward the agenda of support. They have done a commendable job, and with our knowledge partner Yes Bank, we hope to take forward more of such initiatives. And the issues and the challenges which has been raised today, we will be capturing that, taking forward this discussion offline. It's not just the end, it is just rather the beginning of the discussions. We got some key points today. We will be taking these forward more. Unfortunately, because of the constituency meeting, Honorable Minister was not able to join in the morning, and we were optimistic she will be. But somehow here we are. But we will be meeting her personally at her office and presenting a copy of the same. We are really grateful to all the eminent panelists who have come and shared their thoughts. We will be reaching out to you again for more inputs. We are thankful to Mr. Sahu, Commissioner and Secretary, Department of Tourism, Government of Assam, who came in, listened to the panelists, but couldn't participate in the interaction because he just got the call from the CS office. And some of the key takeaways which we got from Nishadji, he mentioned about the challenges which the industry is facing in terms of you know, taxation, and his suggestion especially that like the way Dubai is doing, every 3 years there is a new launch, so there is calling back the tourist flow to a destination, which is I think very useful. We should also suggest that to the various governments that they should focus on these kind of activities and agendas with the private partners. So this, I would like to thank you all for your kind presence, and thank you for especially to Bhupesh ji for having run a wonderful session with the eminent panelists, and look forward to interacting with you all offline today. And I'm sorry we couldn't take up the questions because the time almost it's 2 p.m. It's, you know, almost lunchtime and maybe a little over the lunchtime. So whatever the questions are there, we will take them offline with our eminent panelists and share their responses with our listeners. So with these kind words, I thank you all. Thank you very much for your presence. Thank you.